It's a jump. Come on. One, two, three.
Today we remember the OG Nkalakata, yes, Mandoza, a true legend, left us middle of the day yesterday, 38 years young, the man who made Kwaito music mainstream here in South Africa, Elvis Presley. The word legend is often overused, but in this case, quite apt.
Very apt, very apt and very appropriate. This is the man that I saw room when we were at a conference, 95% of white people dancing to the very first song that came on, and that was Kalagata. That unified South Africa. This is a particular song that carried that particular fame for Mandoza.
Your generation, you grew up with this man, Kendall?
100%. I think we're all pretty much of the same generation, and we all felt the crossover appeal that Mandoza brought. Like, every single neighborhood, every single club across the nation was bouncing to the sounds of this man singing Kalagata in that time.
Yeah, rest in peace to the OG, Mandoza. Of course, today there's a lot of business to be done now. An announcement, well, an expected announcement around 11 o'clock this morning. The High Education Minister, Bladen Zimande, is expected to make some announcement around fees. We'll be right on top of that story in about 2 hours' time. Of course, we are Newsroom. We'll be on air. Our focus today is on drug lords who are using students to transport and sell drugs in various university campuses across the country. Now, question to you today, is there a link between drugs, and I have to include alcohol, drugs and alcohol, and high levels of violence on university campuses? What are your thoughts on this? At SABC Newsroom, that's where you can share us your views. We'd like to hear what you think. We'll also let you know throughout the show the developments with regards to the Higher Education Minister's announcement at around 11 o'clock today. Till we get there, we'll talk about the issue of drugs and violence on South African university campuses this morning. There's a lot of news, as you can understand. It's Monday morning. Let's get our first update with Elvis Presley.
President Jacob Zuma has joined millions of South Africans in extending deep felt condolences on the passing of the Kwaito and crossover legend Mduduzi Tshabalala, popularly known as Mandoza. University students will know later this morning if they will be paying more or not towards their tuition fees next year. That's when the High Education Minister Bladen Zimande announces the much anticipated 2017 university fee structure. And the United Nations General Assembly gets underway today in New York, with South Africa aiming to occupy a meaningful role in the world body. Now, those are all your news headlines, but before we get to the news, let's find out from Kendall Makamate what's happening on the sports front. It was a very busy weekend, Kendall.
As always, Monday morning always brings its whole bag full of tricks that we can talk about. It was a fantastic weekend for sports, and it's great for Team SA that we got a few more goals as the games close. Good morning to you. This is what we've got for you in the sports today. As the 2016 Paralympics come to a close, Dion Buyse and Hilton Langenhoven earned gold and silver, respectively, bringing Team SA's total tally to 17.
Great victory here by Assefa.
And in Cape Town, Assefa Negeo of Ethiopia makes history by running the fastest ever marathon on South African soil.
2 hours, 8 minutes, it looks like about 37 seconds, and that is the fastest unaided run on South African soil.
Nico Rosberg has just about got enough, I think. They're into the last corner. Ricardo's tried everything, but it's Nico Rosberg who wins in Singapore. His first ever win on the streets of Singapore in his 200th Grand Prix. What a result!
Germany's Nico Rosberg celebrates his 200th Formula One race by retaking the championship lead from teammate Lewis Hamilton after a pole-to-flag win in Singapore.
At the start of the season, it all means that he is now ahead.
All this and more we've got for you later on in the Sports Bulletin about 10:40 or so. For now, it's back to Elvis, who's got the news.
Thank you, Kendall. The country is mourning Kwaito legend Mendoza, who died of cancer yesterday at the age of 38. Mendoza, whose real name was Mduduzi Chabalala, lost his battle against the disease while being taken to hospital. President Jacob Zuma is among the many who have expressed their condolences. Despite being ill, Mendoza recently performed at the SABC's Thank You concert at Orlando Stadium in Soweto.
I'm feeling more fire now.
The passing of a legend, the maestro was diagnosed with brain tumor. A frail-looking Mendoza appeared at an SABC concert just last week. At the time, Mendoza spoke about his illness.
I'm here to tell you, I'm still alive. I'm still gonna rock you. Lekenza yahlanya. Lekenza yahlanya.
He said, I'm going to perform and prove to the people that they said I'm dead. I'm not dead. I'll die on stage. I'll die singing. And I was born to do this.
Arrangements have not been finalized at this stage. The family is in mourning.
It's all right.
And you'd always tell me, ever since in primary, I'd always tell my daddy, daddy, I would like to go to a boarding school. And first thing he'd say is, no. I never got a chance to spend time with my dad. So I'm willing to take that chance with you and the other two. So when I'm gone one day, that's what he said to me. I need you to be strong.
I'm severely touched by my brother's departure. I don't think it was his time, and it was hard for me even to come here when his manager asked me. I've been with this man for a long time. He's like my brother to me.
Mendoza was born in Zola South in Soweto. He was raised by his mother and his grandparents. The album Ngalagatsa in 2000 won multiple awards, soaring to the top of the charts on local radio. Hasina Gori, SABC News, Johannesburg.
Well, to his family and close relatives, the president has sent a message of condolences on behalf of the nation. And I can just add my humble voice that indeed our hearts are broken, and at this very difficult time, our hearts go out to them, and may his soul rest in eternal peace. He shall not be forgotten, because his music will play on.
Rest in peace, Kalagata. University students will find out today whether they'll be paying more towards their tuition fees next year. Higher Education Minister Bladen Zamande is expected to announce the 2017 university fee structure in Pretoria at 11 o'clock this morning. Some student organizations have threatened protests if fees are hiked, saying that this year's 0% increase must be carried over to next year. Universities say they need an increase of at least 8% to keep their organizations running or the operations running at full steam. The Council on Higher Education has recommended a 6% increase. Meanwhile, the University of Cape Town has announced it will suspend all classes, lectures and tests for today. This follows a student protest on Friday against a disciplinary tribunal set up against three students that were charged with arson and public violence. Now, the University of Cape Town has announced that it will suspend all classes, lectures and tests, as you heard earlier. Now, in a statement, the university says it took the decision after consulting with various stakeholders. On Friday, students demonstrated against a disciplinary tribunal that was set up against three fellow students charged with arson and public violence earlier this year. The university says the health facility students based in hospitals and clinics are still required to attend to their duties despite classes being suspended. The university will remain open and all staff members are requested to come to work. On the line, we are joined by the Vice Chancellor of UCT, Dr. Max Price. Doctor, very good morning to you and welcome. Can you give us an update about the situation there at UCT, Doctor?
It's pretty much as you just read. We anticipated today to be a day of heightened activity, student protest, possibly people going to Parliament because the minister is making the announcement at 11 o'clock today about the framework for fee increases. In addition, that comes on top of. And so we know that the student movements nationally and on our campus have indicated that some of them have actually said, unless there's a commitment to free higher education, they will continue their protests and escalate their protests. Others, I think, are waiting to see what the ministers offers. The universities, I don't think, will respond immediately because the minister will not tell us what the fees should be. What he will do is give advice and tell us what sort of revenue he's been able to find to give to the universities so that we do not have to put up our fees by the 8% that you referred to. So we need an increase of 8%, but we don't need it from fees. It could come from the government, and the more that can come from government, the less we have to put up the fees, and particularly of poor students and what we call missing middle students, students who are not covered by the National Students Financial Aid Scheme, but come from households where they're still not wealthy enough to afford the full fees. So what we're waiting to hear, and the students are waiting to hear, is how much money, and we'll then have to look at what that means for our campuses. Mm-hmm. So that combination of the activity around the minister's announcement, plus the protest you referred to last week, that tribunal, that student disciplinary tribunal, which concluded its work last week, will probably be issuing its finding today. So that itself may trigger further protest and activity. And we felt that we could not guarantee the safety of students and staff under those circumstances, that we have a campus that's very difficult to secure. We don't have a fence around it, for example. We don't have control over who comes onto campus. And if groups of students decide to go through buildings and disrupt lectures and tests, it's very traumatic for staff and students. And we knew for sure that that was going to happen. And rather than expose students and staff to that, we decided to suspend the lectures. And I hope that, certainly believe that we will try to be back at work tomorrow, but it is unpredictable, of course.
Doctor, how difficult will it be if you do not receive an increase this year?
If we don't, if we don't receive any additional
funding
from the government?
Yes, yes.
That would be hugely difficult. I mean, if you just think about the fact that most salaries in the university, much of our budget is on salaries, and most salaries will increase around about the inflation rate, maybe 1% above inflation. Many of our other costs, such as things that we import, the libraries, all the journals, the consumables that we use in laboratories, go up above the CPI. Because of the exchange rate, they've been going up around 10%, even higher. And then, as you know, the utilities like electricity and water have been going up well above inflation, and we don't have control over those costs. So if we did not get the revenue, we would have to cut back on what we do by approximately 8% if there was nothing for us. And 8% is hundreds of jobs, and it certainly would compromise the quality of the education we offer. It would also compromise our ability to offer financial aid to students because we fund some financial aid ourselves. It would compromise our research output, and the country can be proud of having a number of world-class research institutions, but that depends on adequate funding. And even in the most recent rankings, there was almost all the South African universities that are ranked in the top, say, 800 globally, almost all of them went down a bit because the funding that is coming to higher education, particularly for research, has not kept pace with global trends and even with inflation. So the impact of not getting that money means that either we have to accept a decline in the kinds of universities we have and the funding for students, or we have to put up the fees to compensate. And that will, I think, create a national protest similar to last year. If we can't protect the poor from a fee increase, I think that would likely lead to massive protests, mm-hmm. campaigns to Parliament and against government, and probably a shutdown of the universities.
Just briefly, Doctor, the lectures were suspended. When are we expected to have those lectures resumed?
Well, they've just been suspended for today. Mm-hmm. But I'm hoping that once the minister's announcement has been made and we understand more about the implications of that and the students have digested that and decided to the extent to which it meets the immediate purposes, the immediate goals of protecting poor students or not, that will enable us to continue tomorrow with a more normal situation.
Doctor, thank you so much for your time and joining us here on the newsroom. That was the Vice Chancellor of UCT, Dr. Max Price. Now, the UN General Assembly gets underway in New York today. South Africa's chief diplomat says it would be very strange if this country is not considered a front runner for one of the two proposed permanent seats on a reformed UN Security Council. International Relations Minister Maiten Okwane-Mashabane says that her country has never refused to serve when called upon to do so.
A meeting to thank South Africa for its leading role in Africa, while President Zuma pressed the outgoing UN chief about the urgency of council reform in a world yearning for a more democratic model.
The big powers have become a reason why we are unable to resolve a challenge in a third country when they were supposed to be part of the solution. That is a matter that our president also raised now a few minutes ago with the outgoing Secretary General. This issue of the reforms is no longer just a song. It's a reality. Because then they'll fight for their own interest in a third country. And, you know, when elephants fight, it's the grass that gets hit.
She's talking about Syria, where leading roles by Russia and the United States have failed to save the country from ruin. I asked her why Africa had not yet decided on which countries would fill the two proposed African seats on a reformed Security Council.
When called upon to serve, South Africa has never not availed itself to serve, particularly the interests of the continent. But before we go to, are we going to fight for the two seats? Can we find the seats first? So that we fight over them. So sometimes it's convenient to make Africans fight over non-existent seats. But we have made our case very clear that called upon, we will serve.
How are you?
Earlier, President Zuma also met privately with Klaus Schwab, the executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, and is expected to speak at the US Africa Business Forum on Wednesday. SP's SABC News, New York.
Now that's your news for now. Now our focus this morning is on drugs and alcohol on university campuses, and we want to find out from you, the question is on your screen right now, is there perhaps a link between drugs and alcohol being utilized and being abused really by the students on our campuses? I'd like to get you to send us your comments on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom as well as on our Facebook page. But let's start off that conversation. It's over to Eben.
Yeah, thank you very much. Very good morning if you've just joined us now on that very point. Drug lords are using students to transport and sell drugs in various universities across the country. The South African National Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence, SANCA, says drugs were obtained illegally from students who were dealing with outside drug lords. First-year students are the most targeted buyers as they try to adapt to the new environment and create a new social group. Now, to talk to us a little bit about this and how it plays out on our campuses, we are joined in studio today by Audrey Vermeulen. She's SANCA's convener for the treatment and training programs. Very good morning to you, Audrey. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Good morning,
Evan. This study raised a very important finding, and this about first years being so susceptible to drugs and alcohol in the sort of initial phase of their student career. Why is that so? How does it work out in your research?
I think one has to look at the age group that we are looking at. So we're looking at a very young age group, and that part is of the developmental stage is all about seeking independence and seeking a sense of freedom and also to create a sense of identity for themselves. So they want to experiment, they want to venture out and look for, they test the limits and their own boundaries that were set before. So they all are very susceptible and very vulnerable then to substance abuse because of that reason, of the age group that they are in.
And where does the difficulty come from in today's world? Is it because drugs are much more easily obtainable on campuses and students are really being targeted?
Definitely, and I think there's a range of drugs available to students. So you look at legal as well as illegal substances that are available. Mm-hmm. So if you look at some of the legal ones, we know that some of the students are using a ADHD kind of stimulant medications and prescription medications, and that they use, and that helps them to study further and so on. And even if they don't have a problem with ADHD, they might sell it to other students. And then they would use that to help them study better, to be more focused on what they need to achieve. So we find that the legal and illegal ones are both a problem. And
Both causing problems on the campus. Now, we're asking the viewers today, and it's a fair question. We see high levels of violence on campuses around the country. Do you at Sanka believe that abuse of drugs and alcohol has a role in that?
Definitely, we believe so. In my personal opinion, I can just say that we see that definitely alcohol is a major role in violence and aggression. So we find that that specifically is a very serious concern for us. Then we also find that in our, if you look at further studies that was done through the MRC, you also find that there is a strong link between assault and violence with specific substances that people would use. So for instance, cat, and for instance, crack. So there's definitely a link between violence and
there's
drugs.
There's a definite link between those kinds of drugs and the violence that we see. Now, according to your study or your research, who are the people selling drugs and who are infiltrating our campuses?
I think peers sell to peers. So it's no longer this man that you can't identify on campus. It's a lot of peer pressure that comes with that. And it's also a part of people, that's how people will infiltrate, is through the peer groups. And that is how they would sell the drugs then. And then also all the social kind of events that would happen outside clubs, social clubs, also that is a target for dealers to look at selling these substances to students.
Now, the mixture between the various drugs you're talking about and alcohol generally in other spheres of life leads to unsocial behavior, if you can, or antisocial behavior, if you can call it that. You see this as well?
Definitely. We see that if you look at the consequences of substance abuse and use, we find that that is, affects everything in the person's life. So take control over their personality, their value system, everything changes, and most of all, the behavior changes. So with the behavior changes, we see then the violence, we see the lack of interest. They find that we call it a motivational syndrome. Yeah. So that's what you find with a lot of your first year students, for instance, where there is just a lack of interest in the work. And they're so preoccupied with creating that social environment for themselves that they forget about the academics and how important that would be for their future.
Now is it a question of merely experimenting with drugs for the first years in this case, and how does it play out in their lives and from there on in?
I think it starts with, you have to look at pre-primary even.
Yeah.
And then we also look at primary and secondary, and then the adjustment to varsity lifestyle. So I think all of that plays a role, and maybe the student has already started experimenting from a younger age, and now it's manifested really in when they get to this level, because there's a lack of There's a lack of adult supervision, so a lot of them have that freedom then to experiment a lot more with other chemicals or other substances that they might not have been in contact with before.
So alcohol, in a way, becomes a gateway drug then, is that the fact?
Alcohol is our main problem. on campuses, and I really feel that that is the main concern that we have, mm-hmm. is the alcohol abuse, and specifically binge drinking or risky drinking.
Yeah.
So that for us is a real concern. We've seen reports of students actually fatalities with this kind of behavior, because they are not educated, they don't understand how alcohol poisoning works and how that limits would work. So definitely risky alcohol abuse and binge drinking is a serious concern for students.
If you had an audience with the higher education minister, as Sanka, a little bit after today's important announcement, what would you be telling the higher education minister?
I would tell them to start with policies first and to really look at how do they control and protect students from access of drugs to campuses, and definitely also the outlets around campuses that sells liquor, to really focus on these outlets and to make sure that there's responsible drinking patterns, because we don't want to say no drinking, we want to say that there should be responsible drinking.
And in conclusion, would you say that the problem that we are dealing with on campuses now is out of control, or are we reaching the point of where it's getting out of control?
I really think it is getting out of control. I think that we need to step in very soon with a solution, and definitely to look at how do we link that to education around the dangers of substance abuse.
Well, Audrey, thank you very much for joining us. It's a very concerning matter that we're discussing today, of course. We all know what's happening on our campuses here in South Africa. Thank you very much. Audrey Vermeulen, well, she's SANCA's convener for the treatment and training programs. That's, of course, the South African National Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence. And she makes it very clear, drugs and alcohol are reaching epic proportions on our campuses and needs to be addressed. Now, let's go to Elvis to have a look at what's happening on our social pages right now.
Thank you, Evan, and let's start with the trends on a good note with Team SA, who have won more medals at the Rio Olympics 2016, with Ernst van Dijk winning gold for cycling. Now, the closing ceremony took place last night. Take a look at some of those pictures there coming through. And then, who should be the South African of the Year? Now, some are suggesting that Caster Semenya, or Wade van Niekerk, Black Coffee, or even Thuli Madonsela should be the South African of the Year 2016. What do you say? Let's take a look at some of your comments. You can see them there. And then some sad news, of course, this morning for the South African music industry. As you may already know, the Kwaito star and crossover star Mduduzi Tshabalala, known as Mandoza, has died due to a brain tumor. Mandoza tribute hashtag are circulating the social media sphere. Let's now move to UCT, rather, University of Cape Town hashtag there, where the hashtag Fees Must Fall 2016 is breathing life once more into campuses. Students have already started setting up barricades to the entrances of the university. We just spoke to the Vice Chancellor there, saying it's fairly quiet now. Now, this is ahead of Dr. Bladen Zamande's announcement on the fees increase for later today. We'll know what it will be for next year, 2017. And then a fun fact. Today in history, 24 years ago, the Archbishop Desmond Tutu, ordained two female women as Anglican priest in South Africa. There's a beautiful picture there dating back. And in international news, hashtag Emmys 2016 took over the weekend with the hit series Game of Thrones making the biggest waves at the ceremony, as well as the many celebrities dressed to the nines with their glamorous outfits. Well, there you see Game of Thrones on the blue carpet there. Now, some comments, condolences continue to pour in for the late Kwaito legend Mandoza, who died yesterday afternoon on his way to a Johannesburg hospital. The 38-year-old, whose real name is Mduduzi Tshabalala, had been suffering from a brain tumor. Let's take a look at what you have to say on some of the comments on the Facebook page and on the Twitter handle. This one from Amos says, rest in peace, Mandoza. Hashtag till we meet again. This one from President Nella Mdar says, can the presidency, hashtag, or at presidency ZA, declare the national mourning period for the fallen giant and legend? Mandoza was a patriot throughout. Hashtag rest in peace, Mendoza. This one from Harmonix and says, amazing to see how much Mendoza was appreciated. He was appreciated indeed. And Claire says, rest in eternity, Peace King. Your music and legacy will forever live on. Hashtag Mendoza, and Claire. So those are some of your comments coming through. Keep them coming through on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom. Our picture of the day comes from Quarter Past. Mag and his captioned, he elevated the Kwaito genre, and I would also say the crossover genre, and was able to bring a nation together. Hashtag rest in peace, Mendoza, the OG. Kalaga ta! Well, there you have it from some of the comments there. Our comment of the day comes from Jadine Tager at Jadine85, who says, rest in peace, Mendoza, the guy who managed to successfully cross over Kwaito music to all South Africans. Thank you for the music. I can't agree with you more there on that particular note. And it's absolutely fantastic. When that song came out, everybody got onto the dance floor. Let's take a look what's happening on the in our courts today. And we start off in the Eastern Cape, where a 58-year-old woman is expected to appear in the Willowvale Magistrates Court on a charge of murder. It's alleged that the woman stabbed a 31-year-old man to death at a traditional ceremony at a local village. They had an argument over money allegedly owed to the deceased. Then in the Western Cape, six suspects, including a bank manager who was arrested for their alleged involvement in a bank robbery, are expected to appear in the Kales River Magistrates Court near Cape Town. The suspects, who are aged between 32 and 48, were arrested by the Hawks in conjunction with the police. The robbery took place in Kales River in 2014, and the suspects fled with 500,000 rand in cash. Moving to the northwest, 24-year-old Roy Bengwa is expected to appear in a local magistrate's court for allegedly raping and murdering his stepdaughter. According to police, the mother of the deceased found her daughter bleeding and took her to the local clinic. It was then confirmed that the little girl had been raped and she died hours later. Community members from Ipelegeng Township in Swazi-Renneke are expected to protest against the granting of his bail. And then in Pretoria, a 24-year-old man is expected to appear in the Pretoria Magistrates Court for allegedly murdering 17-year-old Anika Smith 6 years ago. Remember her? Smith was raped before she was killed and her hands were cut off. Her hands were never found. The man handed himself over to police on Sunday. Those are some of the stories happening in the courts, and we'll keep you updated on these cases as they develop. So stay tuned right here. Let's now finish off on a musical note with the legend, Mendoza.
Show me the swanky calisembilo. esikhuthumile njengamalanga bangifuna uhambe nefashion basifunde isifundo sami so angifuna wenze the same flop ubaba alithunile again nehlele ngaphuma ngaphinde ngasurvive ngaphema ama-trucks ngaphuma ngaphinde ngasurvive ngoba ngiyathandaza everyday likhe la mali yazi ukuthi impilo yami ithethi ngiyithele kumdala hloniphi life boy hloniphi impilo boy hloniphi ugogo nomkhulu ukuthi nsuku zande sweshloniphi life boy hloniphi impilo boy hloniphi uyihle nonyoko ukuthi nsuku zande sweshloniphi life boy hloniphi impilo boy hloniphi abonke abantu ukuthi nsuku zande sweshloniphi life boy hloniphi impilo boy respect yourself boy.
Yeah, I'm Duduzi. Tshabalala will be remembered forever. His music will live forever and will, in a way, be forever connected to what happened in South Africa post-democracy now. Of course, today we're looking at drugs on university campuses. The Tshwane University of Technology spokesperson, Villa de Reta, says the TUT student development support has had a number of students approaching it for therapy and support related directly to substance abuse. Now, De Reta said the institutions of higher learning are often targeted by drug dealers. You've heard that a little bit earlier. And reports of illegal drugs being sold at TUT and other campuses have been received on a few occasions. Now, to tell us a little bit more about this specifically in our Pretoria studios, we are joined by Stefan Potgieter. He's a TUT Student Development Support Practitioner. A very good morning to you, Stefan. Thank you for joining us today.
Hi, good morning.
Stefan, we spoke to Sanka a little bit earlier, and the concerning thing, I don't know if you've listened to the interview, the concerning thing that came out of there was that they believe that drugs and alcohol abuse is reaching epic proportions to and is out of control on our campuses in South Africa. What do you say to that?
I think it's definitely a problem that's increasing year by year. For us specifically, I think I just speak earlier about the drug lords that's getting the students to serve as mules for them. I think for us sometimes that's not exactly the problem. The problem is our students going out into the city, buying the drugs there and then just bringing it back onto campus. Campus security is not always able to check and search all the students or all the people that get onto campus for that matter.
We're asking the viewers a question, and of course I asked it to Sanka a little bit earlier again. If there is a link between drug and alcohol abuse and levels of violence that we see on campuses in South Africa, what do you think about that?
I think there's definitely a link. For me, mostly, I would say I think if we look at the student protests that have been happening on campus during the last couple of years due to, you know, the fees must fall movement and things like that. I think a lot of the times what happens there is when classes get shut down, I mean, the students are in such a heightened sense of being rallied up that maybe they then get some alcohol and they go out and they party in the evenings and the next day when they get back onto campus. I mean, it's things just escalate from there.
Yeah, that's interesting that you talk about that, because now the ball's in the court of universities and they're very much under pressure, the tertiary institutions. You guys have been quite proactive with the kind of help you're extending to students. Tell us a little bit about that.
What we do at Student Development and Support, well, we first try and assess, well, what we do basically every year is all the first-year students at the university. We do a student profiling assessment on them where we look at their emotional wellness, their study skills, language proficiency. Based on the results of those assessments, then we can identify the students that might be at risk, emotional issues, study problems. We then have feedback sessions with the lecturers, the heads of department, as well as the students, where we explain to them exactly what it is we assess, and we show them these students might be at risk for emotional problems or things at home that might not be going that lekker. Based on that, then the lecturers in the department will then refer the students to us for whether it is language intervention, study skills, personal counseling or therapy. So we try and assist the first year students as soon as they get into university to help them to adapt to the new environment. Obviously, also the services are available to all our students, second, third year, fourth years, post-graduate students as well.
Now, Stefan, you guys deal directly with the students' face value, really. Which are the substances, in your opinion, that's causing the most concern and becoming the most popular on campuses right now?
For me, from my personal experience in our campuses in the CBD area of Pretoria and Tshwane, I think marijuana is a big problem. As well as then they mix the marijuana with, like we all know, the ARV antiretroviral drugs. Also, even industrial solvents, shoe glue, carpet glue. Those kind of things are really rampant in the CBD, and that's the cheaper drugs that the students can get their hands on. So it's easier for them to get hold of.
And who are the students most at risk, would you say, with these kinds of addictions we're talking about?
That's really difficult to say. I think the one thing about drugs and drug addiction is it doesn't discriminate. You can be from a really disadvantaged background, or you can be from a very privileged background. As soon as the drugs get a hold of you, it doesn't discriminate. So there's not really a way to say that it targets these students most. Obviously, there are factors that play a role. For example, socioeconomic background, and all kinds of things like that, but it really doesn't discriminate.
And quickly tell us about your early warning programs and then your rehab programs.
Our assessment programs, the one that I spoke about now, the student profiling that we do, that is where we try and see which students might be at risk emotionally, and then based on that we will try and get them into a therapy or a counseling program. We also rely a lot on our lecturers. The students sometimes often go to lecturers first with personal problems, and the lecturers will then refer the students to us. As far as our rehab goes, we are not a rehab facility, so we can start with sort of an initial intervention program. We've got counselors, psychologists, social workers all registered and really proficient and efficient at working with it. But for us to do proper rehabilitation, you have to take that person, the student, out of the environment where they are able to get a hold of those drugs and get them into a proper rehab facility. So whether we refer them maybe to Sanka or to a private institution, that's the only way really to deal with a rehabilitation program.
Stefan, thank you for joining us. That's Stefan Potgieter, coming to you live from Pretoria. He is the TUT Student Development Support Practitioner there, telling us that drugs are a real concern on all campuses here in South Africa. Of course, we've been asking you the question, is there a link between high levels of drug and alcohol abuse on our campuses and the high levels of violence that we suddenly see on our campuses? Well, the experts, they've given their view. They say there is a link. You can make that link. What do you think? Let's have a look at some of your views with regards to this. Okay, this one from Thomas Weisskopf. It says, I doubt very much it's a South African thing to achieve something. If it's at universities or in your local municipality concerning service delivery, you get government only that way to listen to the people. Thomas Weisskopf has a different view on this. Well, as you can see, unfortunately, you could see that our computer just packed up. But is it back? There we go. Now, rest in peace in Calcutta says, please do not make the issue of free education an issue of drugs. The real issue here is free education. There's no issue with free education. There's an issue with violence on campuses. Devoe Johnson talks about newsroom. You can find excuses for everything with students, but if parents would do their job as parents, things would be different, says Devoe Johnson. Unati says, newsroom, there is no link at all. They must not blame drugs. Students need free education. Simple as that. Of course, an announcement on fee increases will be made at about 11 o'clock today. We'll be live when Higher Education Minister Blade Nzimande, when he makes that announcement. Of course, you've seen this tension across the campuses. We saw in pictures a little bit earlier that universities' gates are closed. Students having a sitting outside the gates now. We'll be there a little bit later, but let's now take a look at the front pages from around the globe quickly. We'll start in New York. The New York International Times reports that a bomb that detonated in the Chelsea neighborhood of Manhattan, as well as a second that failed to detonate, were made with pressure cookers, flip phones, and Christmas tree-style lights that set off a powerful compound. Down under in Australia, the Australian says Australian aircraft were part of a bombing raid against Islamic State terrorists that went horribly wrong yesterday, when up to 80 Syrian army soldiers were killed by mistake. Then, in Israel, the Jerusalem Post reports that two Israeli police officers were wounded on Monday morning in a terrorist stabbing at Herod's Gate in Jerusalem's Old City. That's according to reports. Those are some of your top stories from around the world. We're going to take a short break. We'll be back right after this.
Provide news updates giving a wealth of knowledge, breaking stories and crossing live for you. We follow business developments intensely. Experts and analysts tackle all challenging issues for you. We cover stories locally and abroad to keep you informed. We cover all sporting codes just for you. We are sure to give you weather to be ready for the day. Stay tuned to News Today at 3 p.m. from Monday to Friday on SABC News.
Now we continue with our theme this morning, drugs in universities and even alcohol. Now, the Northwest University said it had received more than 40 formal incidents of drug abuse on their campuses in the past year. The university also said their protection services work very closely with the South African police services to address the scourge of drugs, which includes random search operations, among others. Now, on how the university is dealing with this challenge, in our studio we are joined by Mario Chauke from the Northwest University Student Counseling Services. Mario, very good morning to you and welcome.
Good morning. Thank you.
Now, Mr. Chauke, in your statement you said that you have over 40 formal complaints, or cases rather, of drugs in your campuses. Does this mean that there are other informal cases which are not reported?
Yes, we can say there are others that are not reported, because if it's not reported, we're not likely to know if the student has a problem. Mm-hmm. But the ones that we know that are reported, they actually go through disciplinary processes. Mm-hmm.
So the 40 is the formal ones. Now, do you have a serious problem at NWU?
As a university, I can say, since South Africa is experiencing the problem, I can say, because the young people are part of South Africa, I can say, yes, we are a little bit experiencing.
Now, according to your university rules, what determines a formal case when dealing with drugs on the campus?
Okay. I think, as it mentioned, that we often have random search operations. If the student is caught, then he has to go through a disciplinary process. Mm-hmm. And the disciplinary process is we have the university that have the disciplinary procedures. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And how long is that process that they need to take through? And do they then are they then enrolled into counseling services?
Yes. In terms of enrolling, we have student counseling. The student counseling is provide your therapeutic counseling for our students. And if the student is caught with the drug illegal ones, then they go through that formal processes. And throughout the bargaining processes, it's either they go for therapy, as well as participating in community work. Mm-hmm. So our services at one of our campus, which is at the Potchefstroom campus, we have Engrape, where we have multidisciplinary services there. So they attend to psychologists or social work if they have a problem after they've been through the disciplinary
process. I see. And how long does it take?
The process is not that long, but the counseling, it will depend on the student, because they have different session with the psychologist. Yes.
How successful is your program thus far?
Because as you can look at it, we have plus or minus 39 students, contact students, for among our three campuses. And the number of students that have reported is 40. It's not easy for us to say it is very successful, but I think we can clearly say that we are working on it.
Now, of those 40 cases, are they all voluntary, or was it students that were caught using illegal drugs?
Those ones were caught, and then they had to go through disciplinary. That's why it is formalized.
Now, are you using other services? Like, you know, my grandmother used to say prevention is better than cure. Are you using services that make students aware of the dangers of drugs?
Yes, we do. The HEAIDS on a strategic plan 2012-2016, they take alcohol and drug abuse very seriously. Mm-hmm. And in every campus, we have HIV and AIDS coordinators. And one of their job is to do awarenesses on HIV, on drug and alcohol abuse. Mm-hmm. Yes.
What is your advice to other universities which are having similar problems like this?
I think I would say that just like we are taking HIV and AIDS very serious, I think we need to start taking drug and alcohol abuse very serious and have awareness campaigns that will actually inform our students about the problem and the negative effects that alcohol and drugs have.
Mr. Chauke, thank you so much for your time and joining us here in studio.
Thank you so much for having me.
Now, that was Mario Chauke from the Northwest University Student Counseling Services joining us here in studio, telling us about their particular case. Right now, let's take a look at some comments with the Higher Education Minister, Bladen Zimande, who was expected to announce the 2017 university fee structure in Pretoria at 11 o'clock this morning. We'll probably go there live as soon as we get that particular link. Let's take a look at those comments. This one from Scutty says, these recommendations are directed to people who can, but what about the ones like me who has no cent now? She's talking about the fees must fall movement that is happening. There must be no increases, she indicates. Marotti says, the government will today reveal university fees for the 2017 academic year. Hashtag fees must fall 2016. This one from Jumkela Max Kerr says, I'm still confused by the free education thing. Like, how is it going to work and who qualifies for it? Will it affect quality education? Well, it stops there. That's one from Jumkela Max Kerr. Hashtag fees must fall. This one from Marotti again. Government and universities have already said a 0% fee increase will bankrupt the institution. So what does that mean? So hashtag fees must fall 2016. Expect that you will have a fee increase for 2017, I would imagine. Now, those are all your comments. You can keep them coming on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom, as well as on the Facebook page, and you can become part and parcel of the Inform. But right now, it's over to Kendall and Evan to talk sports. A very good morning, gentlemen.
Yeah, good morning, Elvis. Good morning to you. Team South Africa bagged 17 medals and finished in 22nd place overall at the Paralympic Games in Rio de Janeiro. Kenna Makamatis, yeah, he thinks it's a successful performance by Team SA.
I think we need to celebrate every single medal that was earned by every single one of those athletes.
Yeah, of
course. Yes, there was a...
But you have to look at the big picture.
The big picture was there was a target that was set on what they were going to earn.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know how they got to that target.
What was the target?
The target was they need to do better than they did in 2012 London.
Now, it was always going to be difficult, wasn't it?
Considering that
Natalie Detroit is not there.
She's not there anymore.
And Oscar Pistorius, who were serial medal winners for us.
Exactamente. We're looking at 7 medals already gone, just those 2 gone. We had 62 athletes, we now have 45 athletes. So it was always going to be a long and difficult task to actually better or even match what was done in London 2012. Having reached 17 medals, I think was fantastic stuff. Special mentions need to be made of a couple of athletes.
Yeah, an outstanding performance.
Andrunay Liebenberg, let me tell you why. Andrunay Liebenberg, she won 2 silvers. She was, a few months ago, she had 2 knee ops.
Yeah.
And she went and won 400 meter silver, 200 meter silver. Fantastic stuff for the 23-year-old. Hilton Langenhofen, fantastic. You know, we have every single one of these athletes needs to be celebrated. We have Danuma Hlango, the 14-year-old who, 2012, couldn't walk, had been in a wheelchair almost his entire life. 5 days after learning, getting the blades, he started running. And he won himself medals. So there are lots of different athletes that I think we need to look at and say, you know what, yes, there was a big thing to look at, but every single one of them, they deserve kudos, I would say.
Job done then, he says, for Team SA at the Paralympic Games. Well, some of them will be returning today already. We'll look forward to their return at the OR Tambo International Airport. Bring that on this very channel a little bit later. Of course, today we're remembering Mandoza.
Ngalagata. Uthi hloniphe life. Uthi ngalagata.
Let's go to break. We'll see you back at 10 o'clock.
Are you ready to jump? Come on. One, two, three.
Health Talk unpacks healthy tips to help you to practice healthy living lifestyles.
Now, generally, type 1 is found mostly in children and young adults, and with type 2 diabetes is found mainly in the older generation and also with an issue of obesity.
Don't have second portions, and then I brought this plate model to show that for both meals, your lunch, your dinner, half a plate should be vegetables.
Within sports, we see the spectrum itself. Most often we see minor head contact injuries, we call them.
Right.
But certainly in sports, the one that a lot of attention is paid to is concussion.
Concussion. You see, you've got something, boom, right, it's uncontrolled. Whereas in soccer, when the guy hits the ball, it's controlled. His neck muscles are controlling it. And that's why they say, for instance, in rugby, the training should be to improve your neck strength.
For more on health, join your host, Dr. Selomo Taung, every Saturday from 9 to 10 a.m.
News Today provide news updates giving a wealth of knowledge. Breaking stories and crossing live for you. We follow business developments intensely. Experts and analysts tackle all challenging issues for you. We cover stories locally and abroad to keep you informed. We cover all sporting codes just for you. We are sure to give you weather to be ready for the day. Stay tuned to News Today at 3 p.m. from Monday to Friday on SABC News.
At Network, we tell you about Africa's social media and technology landscape.
21st century economies rely on technology to truly thrive.
We have quite a comprehensive portfolio of interventions in the tech entrepreneurship space.
And Africans are using tech and social media to solve the continent's unique challenges.
App Nigeria is an online marketplace.
Radio Vibe is a social media platform for radio music.
That's Network with me, Spumelele Zondi, every Sunday at 7:30 p.m. Central African Time.
Now this is Trends, of course, your one-stop serving of all that's juicy and trending in the world of entertainment and showbiz. My name, of course, is Refiel Wemuilo.
I'm Dr. Selomo Taung, and this is Health Talk.
A very good morning and welcome to Media Monitor. I'm your host, Alicia Jali.
My name is Dumile Matez.
Wemuilo Bati.
My name is Mpo.
What time is it? It's question time.
For your daily dose of current affairs, tune in to the SABC News Champ.
We'll be right back.
I'm feeling good, in fact. I'm feeling good. I'm doing what I love, which is my love. And I want to represent.
Yeah, that was one of the last interviews by the OG Ngala Kata. Of course, we're remembering Nduduzi Shabalala Mandoza here in South Africa today. Passed away yesterday, shortly after midday, amongst close family and some friends here in Johannesburg. Now, today, well, we're dealing with issues of drugs on campuses. Do we have a problem with drugs? Our focus is on drug lords who are using students to transport and sell drugs in various universities around the country. Our question of the day, we're asking you, is there a link between drugs and violence? Oh, drugs, alcohol and violence on university campuses. Now, a little bit earlier, the experts told us, yes, there is. It's reaching epic, out-of-control proportions on South African campuses. That was shared a little bit earlier. Now, let's take a look at how are you responding to our question of the day? We're asking you if you think there's a link. Here are some of the responses, Renee.
Yes, this one comes from RIP in Kalagata, who says, please do not make the issue of free education an issue of drugs. The real issue here is free education.
Pumelele DeVoe Johnson says, you can find excuses for everything with students, but if parents had or would do their job as parents, things would be different, says DeVoe.
So from Unati Khrutbum, who says, there is no link at all. They must not blame drugs. Students need free education. Not blame drugs. Students need free education. There we go.
Keep it coming at SABC Newsroom is where you can share your thoughts with us. That's what we do here on Newsroom, your platform where you can interact with the news of the day. There's lots of other news, of course, happening. Let's go to the news desk with Rene for our update.
President Jacob Zuma has joined millions of South Africans in extending deep-felt condolences on the passing of Kwaito legend Nduduzi Tshabalala, popularly known as Mandoza. University students will know later this morning if they will be paying more or not towards their tuition fee next year, when the Higher Education Minister, Dr. Bladen Zimande, announces the much-anticipated 2017 university fee structure. And the United Nations General Assembly gets underway today in New York, with South Africa aiming to play a meaningful role in the world body. Before we get to that news, let's find out from Kendall what's happening in the sports.
Good morning. Good morning. Quite a lot happening on the sports. We know the Paralympics closed yesterday, but we also know there's a lot to look forward to in terms of sports for this week. Good morning to you as well as to everybody at home. This is what we've got for you in the sports today. As the 2016 Paralympics come to a close, Dion Buys and Hilton Langenhoven earn gold and silver, respectively, bringing Team SA's total tally to 17.
Great, great victory here by Assefa, the Ethiopian.
And in Cape Town, Assefa Negewo of Ethiopia makes history by running the fastest ever marathon on South African soil.
8 minutes, it looks like about 37 seconds, and that is the fastest unaided run on South African soil.
Nico Rosberg has just about got enough, I think. They're into the last corner. Ricardo's tried everything, but it's Nico Rosberg who wins in Singapore. His first ever win on the streets of Singapore in his 200th Grand Prix. What a result!
And Germany's Nico Rosberg celebrates his 200th Formula One race by retaking the championship lead from teammate Lewis Hamilton after a pole-to-flag win in Singapore.
In a row at the start of the season, it all means that he is now ahead in the championship by 8 points. He's on 273 versus Lewis Hamilton on 260.
Now all this and more we'll bring to you later on in the sports bulletin about 10:40 or so. For now, it's back to Renee who's got the news.
Thank you very much, Kendall. The country is in mourning today after Kwaito legend Mandoza died of cancer yesterday at the age of 38. Mandoza, whose real name was Nduduzi Tshabalala, lost his battle against the disease while being taken to hospital. President Jacob Zuma is among the many who have expressed their condolences. Despite being ill, Mandoza recently performed at the SABC's Thank You Concert at Orlando Stadium in Soweto.
I'm feeling more fire now.
The passing of a legend. The maestro was diagnosed with brain tumor. A frail-looking Mendoza appeared in an SABC concert just last week. At the time, Mendoza spoke about his illness.
I'm here to tell you, I'm still alive. I'm still gonna rock you.
He said, I'm going to perform and prove to the people that they said I'm dead. I'm not dead. I'll die on stage. I'll die singing. And I was born to do this.
Arrangements have not been finalized at this stage. The family is in mourning.
It's all right.
And you would always tell me, ever since in primary, I would always tell my daddy, I would like to go to a boarding school. And first thing he'd say is, no. I never got a chance to spend time with my dad. So I'm willing to take that chance with you and the other two. So when I'm gone one day, that's what he said to me. I need you to be strong.
I'm severely touched by my brother's departure. I don't think it was his time, and it was hard for me even to come here when his manager asked me. I've been with this man for a long time. He's like my brother to me.
Mendoza was born in Zola South in Soweto. He was raised by his mother and his grandparents. The album Inkalakatsa in 2000 won multiple awards, soaring to the top of the charts on local radio. Hasina Gori, SABC News, Johannesburg.
Well, to his family and close relatives, the president has sent a message of condolences on behalf of the nation. And I can just add my humble voice that our hearts are broken. And at this very difficult time, our hearts go out to them. And may his soul rest in eternal peace. He shall not be forgotten because his music will play on.
University students will find out today whether they'll be paying more towards their tuition fees next year. Higher Education Minister Dr. Bladen Zimande is expected to announce the 2017 university fee structure in Pretoria at around 11 o'clock this morning. Some student organizations have threatened protests if fees are hiked, saying this year's 0% increase must be carried over to next year. Universities say they need an increase of at least 8% to keep their operations running at full steam. The Council on Higher Education has recommended a 6% increase. Meanwhile, the University of Cape Town has announced it will suspend all classes, lectures and tests for today. This follows a student protest on Friday against a disciplinary tribunal set up against three students charged with arson and public violence. Meanwhile, the UCT Vice Chancellor, Dr. Pax Price, says the university had to shut down its doors for the safety of its students and staff. Speaking to SABC News this morning, Dr. Price says the protests can be avoided at universities as there are other ways of raising the money for universities without increasing the fees.
We know that the student movements nationally and on our campus have indicated that some of them have actually said unless there's a commitment to free higher education, they will continue their protests and escalate their protests. Others, I think, are waiting to see what the minister's offers. The universities, I don't think, will respond immediately because the minister will not tell us what the fees should be. What he will do is give advice and tell us what sort of revenue he's been able to find to give to the universities so that we do not have to put up our fees by the 8% that you referred to. So we need an increase of 8%, but we don't need it from fees. It could come from the government. And the more that can come from government, the less we have to put up the fees, and particularly for poor students and what we call missing middle students, students who are not covered by the National Student Financial Aid Scheme, but come from households where they're still not wealthy enough to afford the full fees. So what we're waiting to hear, and the students are waiting to hear, is how much money, and we'll then have to look at what that means for our campuses. Mm-hmm. So that combination of the activity around the minister's announcement, plus the protest you referred to last week, that tribunal, that student disciplinary tribunal, which concluded its work last week, will probably be issuing its finding today. So that itself may trigger further protest and activity. And we felt that we could not guarantee the safety of students and staff under those circumstances, that we have a campus that's very difficult to secure. We don't have a fence around it, for example. We don't have control over who comes onto campus. And if groups of students decide to go through buildings and disrupt lectures and tests, it's very traumatic for staff and students. And we knew for sure that that was going to happen, and rather than expose students and staff to that, we decided to suspend the lectures.
The UN General Assembly gets underway in New York today. South Africa's chief diplomat says it would be very strange if this country is not considered for front runner for one of the two proposed permanent seats on a reformed UN Security Council. International Relations Minister Maite Nkuana-Mashabane says her country has never refused to serve when called upon to do so.
A meeting to thank South Africa for its leading role in Africa, while President Zuma pressed the outgoing UN chief about the urgency of council reform in a world yearning for a more democratic model.
The big powers have become a reason why we are unable to resolve a challenge in a third country, when they were supposed to be part of the solution. That is a matter that our president also raised now a few minutes ago with the outgoing Secretary General. This issue of the reforms is no longer just a song. Mm-hmm. It's a reality. Because then they'll fight for their own interest in a third country. And, you know, when elephants fight, it's the grass that gets hurt.
About Syria, where leading roles by Russia and the United States have failed to save the country from ruin. I asked her why Africa had not yet decided on which countries would fill the two proposed African seats on a reformed Security Council.
When called upon to serve, South Africa has never not availed itself to serve, particularly the interests of the continent. But before we go to, are we going to fight for the two seats? Can we find the seats first so that we fight over them? So sometimes it's convenient to make Africans fight over non-existent seats. But we have made our case very clear that called upon, we will serve.
How are you?
Earlier, President Zuma also met privately with Klaus Schwab, the executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, and is expected to speak at the US-Africa Business Forum on Wednesday. SABC News, New York.
Labour Federation COSATU will be convening a special centre executive committee meeting today. The meeting will serve to address COSATU's response to changes in the political climate. The meeting has been called to deal with some of the issues which were not concluded at the last CEC in August. The rebuilding of a more united COSATU will be at the core of today's meeting. The 2 million member federation lost membership following the expulsion of its biggest affiliate, NUMSA. The succession of its alliance partner, the African National Congress, will also be on the agenda. COSATU President Stumo Dlamini says that as alliance partners, the federation is also interested in who should lead the ANC next year. COSATU's Central Executive Committee is meeting today and is expected to discuss its endorsement of Deputy President Cyril Ramaphosa to become the next president of the ANC. Meanwhile, the Young Communist League has said it does not support Dr. Nkosi Dlamini-Zuma to become the next president of the ANC.
The succession debate. Several slate combinations are in circulation. None have been confirmed by the ANC. But there is growing support for Deputy President Cyril Ramaphosa. The YCL says the ANC's various leagues are compromised, and any candidate from these leagues would be equally compromised.
We don't have a confidence on any candidate that is proposed by the ANC Youth League, by the Women's League, and the MKMVA. Because the MKMVA, the ANC Youth League, and the Women's League is part of those who are liquidating the African National Congress.
The YCL also proposed that its mother body, the SACP, contest the 2019 election. The SACP, part of the Tripartite Alliance, has never contested a poll.
South African Communist Party does not have a resolution to contest state power. The Young Communist League, as the youth wing of the SACP, since 2005, has been calling for the SACP to contest state power through the ballot.
The league also called on President Zuma to investigate whether SARS head Tom Moyane is suitable to be the country's chief tax collector. For some time, Moyane has been at loggerheads with Finance Minister Pravin Gordhan. Gordhan has been investigated by the Hawks over a SARS intelligence unit set up during his watch. Gordhan has answered all 27 questions put to him by the Hawks.
Mr. Moyane has failed dismally in the execution of his duties, and the credibility of SARS continue to wane under his leadership.
The YCL expect the SACP to table a resolution on contesting elections during its conference next year. Muntlenyane Dipoku, SABC News, Johannesburg.
A group of Zimbabweans have been protesting outside the United Nations building in New York as the movement to remove President Robert Mugabe from power gathers steam.
We need to speak with one voice. We finally have found our voice. We cannot let anyone stop us. We need to make sure the people that are running any party that's coming up, we need them to understand that we are no longer going to be used by one person who is feathering their agenda.
We're protesting against Mugabe because he needs to go. He's been in power way too long. And it's time for someone new, and we're tired of him.
What would your message be to President Mugabe?
My message to President Mugabe is, when we came out of independence, when we were born, you promised us a future. We got educated, and now we want to promise our kids the same future. But you have totally failed us, and it's time for the whole system, not just the president himself, but the whole system, the structure, the ZANU-PF structure, just has to go.
That's our top news for this hour. After the break, we'll be discussing decolonizing knowledge. Stay tuned.
Keeping you up to date with business developments.
There's no shortage of money in the system. There's a shortage of implementation capacity to actually get things done.
Always on point with news of the day.
May has promised radical social and economic reforms, fueling speculation over the future of current senior figures.
On the ball every time with all sports codes.
The Joburg side already have a quarter-final at home, and a victory against the Argentines will ensure home semi-final.
Accurate weather updates after every bulletin. Stay tuned to News Today at 3 p.m. from Monday to Friday on SABC News.
A conscious move from being a street kid to being a barrister of note.
Keep on praying for me to make a better life.
A creative application of the mind on an essential need, water in wheelbarrow containers.
How about if we'd come up with an idea of an enclosed container that sits on top of the frame of a wheelbarrow?
With the sharing of resources, a boy with Russell Silver syndrome receives medication.
The fact that you just said to me, well, you're covered for next month, that's amazing.
So that's the medication.
For more inspiring stories, stay tuned to Bophelong every Friday.
Welcome back with Newsroom on SABC News. Now, as our tertiary institutions continue to fight for transformation, we see the issues that were once swept under the carpet by the apartheid regime resurface, such as equality, language policy, and the demon called racism. We also recently saw the changing of outdated school codes of conduct during what became the hair debacle here in South Africa. However, to get to the bottom of these issues, there's a need for transformation in our basic education platforms as well, in particular the curriculum, some say. But how do we begin to decolonize knowledge? Yes, decolonize knowledge. And will this aid in decreasing racism and promoting social cohesion in South Africa? Now, joining us on our panel this morning is a researcher at the Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute, Dr. Edith Pashwane. She's with us. Next to her is the Executive Secretary of the Africa Forum, Professor John Tasha. And in our Pretoria studio this morning is UNISA's African Studies Professor, Sabelo Ndlovu. A very good morning to you, Professor Ndlovu. And thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Thank you.
I want to start with the African perspective. Professor Tasha, I want you to kind of get our heads around decolonizing knowledge and what that understanding should be within the African context.
Well, thank you. That's a very interesting question. You decolonize country, you don't decolonize knowledge. It becomes very, very difficult. I think when we talk of mindset, and it's important to understand from what perspective are we coming from. In my view, I think we need precisely to decolonize knowledge.
Yeah,
it's not essentially an issue of epistemology, but it's an issue of mindset, that you come from one historical era to a new historical era, and your mindset has not changed. We at this continent have a big dilemma on this. I always say, well, yes, politically we have decolonized the countries, but economically we haven't, and even worse, we have not changed our mindset.
We haven't decolonized knowledge, and Dr. Pashwane, how do we, what do we suffer as at the effect of this, or because of this? What is it that we are suffering right now?
I think I should just start maybe with conceptual clarity on colonization, colonialism, and coloniality. Because colonization is, if you see colonization as an event that began in 1492, where a particular distant territory occupies another territory, that is what we speak of when we speak of colonization. But when we speak of colonialism, here we are speaking of a process that erases certain cultures, a process that comes as a means of civilization, as a means of modernizing certain territories.
Yeah.
So that one manifests actually at the metaphysical, at the level of the abstract.
Yeah.
At the abstract level, and hence that we see ourselves struggling for. But when we speak of coloniality, we speak of the invisible power structures that continues to sustain colonialism long after direct colonialism, the two that I spoke about earlier, has ended. It continues. It means that it manifests the visions of art, you know, how you see art, education, the monopoly of knowledge.
Yeah.
As well, and also You see it in the way we think and the way we do things, political formations of political...
In all our institutions, it's almost institutionalized, if one can call it that.
Yes, I agree. It is institutionalized, and one can see it in terms of space and how the space is shared, how the culture at our institutions are. They promote particular kind of knowledge, which is Eurocentric.
Let me go to Pretoria quickly. I want to talk to Professor Sabelo, and I want to ask you, Professor Ndlovu, is the knowledge that we are subjected to right now, especially in the textbooks, I want to take it down to young people, is it still from a colonial perspective, and how do we decolonize that, if that is the case?
For the question, I think the starting point is really to go back to the idea of the university itself, because you can't actually change the curriculum without changing the idea of the university itself. The problem with the university which we are having at the moment is that we have universities in Africa rather than African universities. In other words, we're talking about universities which actually behave as offshore universities, which account for the standards outside the continent, but are not responsive to the local where they are actually located.
Mm.
So one issue which is very important is to change the very character of the university so that at the center of the university, we take into account seriously ourselves as thinkers, as producers of the knowledge. And this becomes important now because there is a definitive entry of black people into the universities, and they are loudly claiming that they are also human beings. As human beings, they are born into valid knowledge.
Yeah.
But when they enter into the university, they found that African knowledges are not there. They continue to be fed knowledges which come from elsewhere.
Mm.
And this is the challenge which we are facing at the moment, because we must accept that despite the fact that we talk about global economy of knowledge, that knowledge actually circulates from a particular center, and that center must be specified. It is Europe and North America.
Yeah.
And then it circulates into other parts of the world. But at the moment, we want to do what Ngugi wa Thiong'o talks about as moving the center from Europe and North America to ourselves, to Africa, and begin to think from where we are into other parts of the world rather than thinking from Europe into Africa.
Professor, thank you for that contribution. If I can ask Professor Tesha, sort of diplomatically, is there a responsibility or a growing understanding that this needs to happen at a diplomatic level before it filters down?
No, I'm not sure about that, but I think... many diplomats would agree that it's not only the university buildings, it is also the knowledge.
Yeah.
And it would really depend on how Africa takes this seriously and ensure that our universities have the right curriculum based on our own culture and value systems. But what has happened is that, yes, we have decolonized the continent, but most people on the continent, especially those in universities, students and so on, they remain, you have a human being who is politically Afrocentric.
Yeah.
They talk politics about this continent. They discuss a lot. They know how to agitate. But culturally, Eurocentric. And it's the conflict, and this is the conflict between the political Afrocentricity of politics and the European and culture and the Eurocentricity of culture, that they remain in their minds, they remain largely part of Europe. I mean, if you ask students now which is the best university in the world, they won't refer to their own universities. They will refer to universities in Europe. And if you ask a student, where do you want to study? They will say, I want to go to Oxford, I want to go to Cambridge. But we have institutions that are just as doing as better as much as they can. So we need a mindset shift. We need a paradigm shift.
Yeah. Dr. Edith, is that paradigm shift, is it about getting African researchers to to study Africa once again and then representing it to us?
Definitely, that is also about getting Africa. And let me start by indicating that it does not mean Africa never contributed to the current knowledge that we have.
Mm.
It has, but this knowledge was the Eurocentric knowledge we are talking about was appropriated from all parts of the world. But what happened is that in the appropriation of these knowledges, some of them were distorted, and actually a huge amount of them were distorted because of Eurocentric assumptions of how knowledge is created, where you have to detach the known from the knower.
Yeah.
And where the knower is able to interpret everything in the world, and which is universal. So this is where the problem is. I agree that we need African researchers, students. Our students need to do the. I mean, just to give you an example, I have a student who wants from a previous university that I was at.
Yeah.
Who wanted to study philosophy, and he wanted to study the philosophy of Achimafeje. And he was pointedly told that Achimafeje is not a philosopher by the lecturers who were supposed to interview him. And which means there is a need for students to unpack this African archive, but there are blockages within the current university systems that we have.
Let me go to Professor Sabelo Ndlovu in Pretoria. Professor, just to take it back a little bit even further, what about the kind of transformation at basic school level that we need to implement here in South Africa? Would this aid in that decolonization process?
I didn't get your question properly, but let me try to respond. I think one of the issues which is emerging clearly from the discussion is the question of if indeed African knowledges are marginalized, if indeed African knowledges are not at the university, I think the fundamental question which we need to deal with is the question of who is marginalizing this knowledge. And if we're talking about Africans being the producers of knowledge, we need to ask a second question: what type of Africans are we talking about? Because you can actually bring in a lot of black bodies into the center of the university, but they carry Eurocentric thinking as well. So the problem really is about which African you are talking about. Is the one who has internalized Eurocentric thinking, or the one who is rebelling against Eurocentric thinking? And one of the major problems is that all the professors, black and white, they are produced by similar universities. And as such, it is not really about just bringing the African into the center of the university, and you think that that person will produce African knowledge. It is actually about shifting the consciousness of the academic who is producing the knowledge. And we're seeing that the first thing which needs to happen, it is to change the mindset of the academics themselves, because there are a lot of black professors at the university, but they continue to produce curriculum which is Eurocentric.
Thank you, Professor. That's Professor Sabelo Ndlovu, who is an African studies professor at UNISA. Thank you for joining us from the capital. I'll finish up here in studio quickly. Dr. Edith, language.
Mm-hmm.
What's the role that language has to play within this process?
And I think here I want to draw on Ngugi wa Thiong'o, that language within a university that we are imagining, it should be a space where there is multilingualism.
Mm-hmm.
All languages of the world must be able to participate in that kind of a university. In fact, decolonial scholars are talking about a pluriversity, which in the sense it means you come together in an inter-epistemic dialogue and come together to produce the kind of knowledge that is one. I mean, decolonization is not an issue that is applicable to South Africa alone or Africa.
Mm-hmm.
The whole of the global south, India, Asia, Latin America, the Caribbean, everyone is subjected to this process. It's a liberation struggle for the global south to shift the geographies of knowledge, and so that the knowledges that were essentially excluded from the knowledge center should also play a part in this process.
Professor Teshup, in conclusion, how would you like to take this process forward? With it's an uncomfortable process for sure. What would you like to see happen?
Well, what I would like to see happen is first a change in curriculum.
Yeah.
A curriculum that focuses on Africa and African values.
Yeah.
But that will require language other than the languages that we're using. Nobody says we should not use English or French, but we must have a language that, a medium of instruction that is common to us all, to Africa, that speaks to the values and systems of the continent.
Mm-hmm.
That way we produce an African who is certainly an African and who can speak on behalf of the continent. It's not about South Africa. It's not about Tanzania. It's about the continent.
What's your final words, Dr. Edith, on us going down this path of decolonizing knowledge?
I would like to say that currently, you see, there's a form of dismissing or, you know, diffusing this process of decolonization, which mm-hmm. has tended to be something that it is not. People, we must be wary in this process that we are not creating new systems of power, recreating new systems of power. And also, we must also be able to understand that we are not creating xenophobia,
you know,
narrow nationalism. We are not also going back to create new forms of domination that are patriarchal, that are tribalistic, you see. Because so, I see that, because decolonization, it seems like it's taking everything. Everyone who has an agenda, you know, comes in and wants to say, I am decolonizing. So we need to be very careful and
we have some movements that talk to that now. We've got a decolonization foundation, for instance, in South Africa. So it's a fine line, as you point out, and we have to make sure that it doesn't become narrow nationalism. Before I let you go, Professor Tesh, I want you to put on your hat as the Executive Secretary of the Africa Forum. I wanted to know if I can ask you, what do you think of the kind of protests that we've seen in Zimbabwe now, and we've seen protests at the UN, and what would you like to see with regards to Zimbabwe, both on a sort of AU level, but also in the country?
What is going on in Zimbabwe now is very unfortunate. Zimbabwe has still an enlightened leader, a leader who really understood what the continent was all about and what his people wanted. Now, some would say perhaps he overstayed, and in the process he forgot the way forward.
Mm.
Others would say, no, it's just arrogance of politics, and he doesn't want to. Now, the demonstrations are not the first demonstration on this continent.
Mm.
But I think we hope all the Zimbabweans will come together for the sake of Zimbabwe. If you remember, Zimbabwe was a breadbasket of the SADC, of the Southern African countries. The economy has gone down. And there are many questions we would ask. Why is this happening? Is it leadership?
Mm.
What is it that it's happening? Now you have people running out of Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe had the very high manpower. Are they still in Zimbabwe? I doubt. They're out. How do they get back? They want to see peace, stability, and prosperity in Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
And that situation will have to come up one way or another. And I think the future is bright for Zimbabwe. They all need to go through this transition.
Thank you for joining us. That's Professor John Teshe, the Executive Secretary of the Africa Forum, and of course Dr. Edith Pashwani is the researcher at the Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute. Today we were talking about what's on screen there, decolonizing knowledge. That's been what we focused on right now. But let's go back to our main story on Newsroom today, where Higher Education Minister Bladen Zimande is expected to announce the 2017 university fee structure in Pretoria at 11 o'clock this morning. That's in, about 20 minutes' time. Now, reporter Sipho Stierman, he's already there, making sure that we get the minister alive this morning. Sipho, very good morning to you. We're counting down to this, much awaited announcement. What's the expectation then?
A very good morning to you indeed, Eben, and welcome to Pretoria, where we are outside the GCIS, where the Minister of Education, Higher Education, Blaine Zimande, will be announcing the fees for 2017. As you mentioned, it really has been a long-awaited announcement. You would remember that actually last month he had communicated with the media that he was going to make an announcement, but then there was a last-minute postponement suggesting that he was going to continue consulting so that he can come at the right decision. Now, what's interesting is that throughout this waiting period, we've had the Fees Commission running, and during the Fees Commission, we've had Treasury coming on board saying that they have not budgeted for another zero fee increment, and that is something that did not sit well with the students, and they're saying that they want to see zero fee increment for 2017. And that they will not accept anything else. So it has been a very tricky situation for the department, because Treasury made it clear that there is no money for that. And if we have to continue with a blanket zero fee increment, then we'll have to increase taxes, or a budget will have to be taken from another department. And the question is now, what other department is going to have to lose the students to further fund students? And you will remember, of course, NFSA's budget is already at 10 billion. And of course, last year as well, as part of fees must fall as zero a fee increment. The government, on top of the 10 billion, added 6.9 billion to help fund the universities to make up for that zero fee increment. So big money are already being pumped into the education sector, and now we're going to hear if there's going to be more of the zero fee increment. And with me, I've got students here, Nomta Sobe from University of Pretoria. She's a SRC treasurer there. I know you've mentioned that as students, you are not moving away from your zero fee increment demand. For how long do you want this zero fee increment to last? Because Treasury has said it's not sustainable.
Ideally, we don't want it to last at all. We want a more sustainable solution. I mean, we can't keep saying 0% every year, because we still can't afford the 0% increment. So the idea is to have the 0% increment now until you have figured out how to scrap the 0% and give free education at some point.
You mentioned until they have figured it out. How are they supposed to figure it out? What figuring out are you talking about?
Well, the commission was supposed to give us feedback, and they failed to give us feedback. And everyone is still waiting for the commission to give us feedback. So we need to know, is the commission going to give us feedback? Is the commission done? Are they not? Are they saying it's not possible at all? And to look into where other money can be taken in terms of how government is spending money, so that it can go back into education and higher learning.
A blanket zero fee increment does not just help the poor. The rich also benefit from it, because it's a blanket one. So it doesn't really address the issue of the poor not being able to go to universities.
It doesn't. And one of the things we're expecting that the announcement might be is that they will assist, they'll keep the NSFAS model for what they call the poor students, and then they'll categorize the missing middle into classes and subsidize the classes according to how rich they are deemed to be, and then the rich will still have to pay. So it's very complicated, and it's going to be very interesting to see how it's going to go moving forward, because again, how are you defining what the missing middle is? How are you defining who's too poor and who's too rich?
All right, okay, let's move along now to Kabelo Mahlobongwane. He's the EFF student command at the University of Pretoria as well. So should you not get the zero fee increment that you are expecting, what will you do?
Look, we are saying that last year at the meeting at the union buildings with the president, there was an agreement that the 0% fee increment is being granted on a condition that the commission has to sit and now give us a model this year that's going to be able to sponsor free education. So we are saying that this year we're not going to play these games anymore. We don't want to see ourselves next year striking again for the same issues. We want free education. Should they fail to announce, we are going to shut down the whole of South Africa as the students command until a black child is recognized and the struggle of free education is realized, because we want free quality education. These things of 0% free increments and all that, they're just going to delay and delay our struggle, because the very same fees now are expensive. We can't afford them. So if there's 0%, where are we going to get the money that's already expensive?
All right, but then that is what the Fees Commission is trying to address, to identify who should be funded, who is the poor. It's working on mechanisms to establish that, as we have mentioned, that a blanket zero fee increment does not really address the issue. So why is it that you cannot give the Fees Commission time to do its work and come up with mechanisms that will define who should be funded and who shouldn't be?
The government doesn't seem to understand the urgency of this matter. But again, as the students command, we are calling for free education for everyone. Green one, this thing of having to classify people and categorize people, because look now, the same NSPAS model is a model that seeks to classify people from poor to those ones who are better poor to those ones who are better rich, and they can fund them. But they're failing because now, at the end of the day, we have the missing middle right, which is not being funded. For example, if someone now has a family which earns, let's say, 150, the household income, and these two families, one family has got two students on campus studying, the other family has one student, and one family has got black taxes, well, there's a lot of things there. The remainder of the money won't be the same for two families because one is going to have to spend more, one is spending less. So you want free education. There's no model that can define a person as being poor, especially for black students, because we have to go back and support our families, we have to pay back NSPAS and such things.
All right, and just very briefly, I understand another issue that you students have is the fact that some of the student leaders that were calling for fees to fall in 2016 are still suspended, and that is something that you want to see change.
Definitely. It's one of the things that we are calling for, that these issues need to be addressed. Why are these students still suspended? I mean, why are we even having this conversation at this point?
All right, do you want to add to that?
Yes, I want to say that we are supporting the students of UKZN, Stellenbosch, and all those who are already starting the struggle about the bringing back of our leaders. We'll also join them definitely on that one. It's part of our memorandum for this year. We want all student leaders who have been suspended and victimized to come back to campus and continue their studies. So it is going to happen. Whether 0%, we still want those students to come back to campus.
All right. Well, are you hearing it for yourself, Ben? The students are saying zero fee increment and nothing else, and that the Fees Commission, which of course is working to find mechanisms to define who should be funded, who is poor and who is rich and who should pay, should do its work quite urgently. And they're saying that up until that commission has made a decision, the moratorium on the fees, that is the 0% fee, should stay in place. And also another demand is that leaders that started the Fees Must Fall movement last year, the suspensions should be lifted. So there is quite a number of demands, but what's clear is that students are calling for 0% fee increment. It will be interesting to see what the minister announces here today.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sipho, for that update. Yes, the Minister, Higher Education Minister Blade Nzimande, is under pressure to come up with a solution that's going to make everyone happy. Whether that is possible in the short term is a completely different story. So don't go away now. At 11 o'clock, that announcement will be made. We're monitoring all the campuses around the country to see the response and the reaction to that announcement first up. But let's just take a quick look at what's happening on the front pages here on the African continent. We'll start in Angola, where the Jornal de Angola reports that the revised state budget of 2016 will today receive a final overall vote after being discussed and approved in that country. In Nigeria, the Daily Trust says federal government colleges across the country reopened for the 2016-17 session yesterday, but some students who could not pay complete fees were turned back. Finally, in Namibia, the Namibian reports that three contracts worth 1.4 billion Namibian dollars to supply 60,000 tons of railway material to the revamped Walvis Bay Tumab line attracted no less than 225 bids. Very interesting. Well, that's our news.
Welcome back. Thank you very much, Eben. It's time for the sports right now, and it's Monday morning, and our big news is about the Paralympics, where Team South Africa bagged 17 medals and finished in 22nd place. This as the Paralympic Games in Rio de Janeiro drew to a close. The South Africans won 7 gold, 6 silver and 4 bronze medals. That's 12 less than in London 4 years ago.
Two South Africans competed at the London Paralympics. These included the likes of multiple medalists Oscar Pistorius and Natalie Detoy. 4 years later, a smaller squad of 45 travelled to Rio, but still featured the experienced Ans van Dijk, Dion Bose, Zanele Situ and Shireen Sapiro. Van Dijk competed in his 7th and final Paralympic Games, the end of an era. He claimed gold in the cycling road race, his 8th Paralympic medal overall. But it was a 14-year-old South African sprinter who raced into the hearts of sports lovers around the world and into the history books. Blade runner Thando Mahlangu won silver in the T42 200 meters event, setting a new African record of 23.77 seconds.
Gets the silver!
Mahlangu, however, was not the only South African teenager in Rio with a promising future. Rower Dylan Trollope, swimmer Alani Ferreira and athlete Liesel Gous will carry the hopes of millions of South Africans to the 2020 Tokyo Paralympics. The Rio squad represented a balanced mix of youth and experience.
If you take into consideration the nature of the team that we've got now, remember this is now a new era. Many of them who are here for the third time. And I think what is happening here is it's almost like a handover to the younger generation that is taking place here.
Team South Africa is expected back in the country tomorrow morning, where a welcome ceremony is planned at OR Tambo International Airport. Liesel Zankel, SABC News.
Cut.
You know, I sure hope that you'll all be out there to support the South African Paralympic team, who've done extremely well out at Ortea tomorrow. Now, the Absa Premiership matches resume tomorrow after a weekend with champions. Mamelodi Sundowns played in the CAF Champions League in Zambia. Also in action over the weekend were Bidvest Wits and Cape Town City in an MTN 8 semi-final clash. The Cape Townians will travel to Soweto for a clash against Orlando Pirates, and Wits will be away to Baroka FC.
Baroka, who lost 2-1 to fellow rookies Highlands Park last week, will welcome Bidvest Wits at the Peter Mokaba Stadium in Polokwane on Tuesday evening. Bahaha want to forget about their previous match where they failed to convert two of their three penalty kicks in Tembisa. Wits, on the other hand, have not scored a goal in their last two matches since putting three past Schwab Walters in the MTN 8 first leg semi-final in Johannesburg. The leading goal scorer with 5 in 2 matches, Tandai Ndoro, is deadly in front of goals, and Cape Town City should be wary of his speed and goal scoring prowess. On Tuesday, former Orlando Pirates coach Eric Tingler will lead his troops against the Buccaneers at Orlando Stadium after exiting the MTN 8 competition on Saturday. In another match on Tuesday evening, Polokwane City will be up against Ajax Cape Town in the Mother City. There will be three Absa Premiership matches on Wednesday. Kaizer Chiefs will be in Makulong Stadium in Tembisa for their clash against Highlands Park. Maritzburg United, who held champions Mamelodi Sundowns to a goalless draw last week, will host SuperSport United, and the Golden Arrows will be away to Free State Stars. Meanwhile, the Brazilians, who have a tight schedule, will entertain the enterprising Chipa United in the second leg of the MTN 8 semi-final at the Lucas Moripe Stadium in Pretoria. The first leg ended 0-0. Mduduzi Ndlovu, SABC News.
Now, you just heard about how Mamelodi Sundowns had done over the weekend. Well, their coach, Pito Mosimane, has praised his players for fighting back after going 2-0 down against Zesco United of Zambia in the CAF Champions League first leg semi-final game in Indola on the weekend. The Brazilians scored a late away goal in a match that ended 2-1. The second leg will be played in Pretoria this coming Saturday. Let's hear what the coach had to say.
Sundowns is growing as a team. They're getting matured and understanding continental football. This is how you play continental football.
Goal scorer of the all-important away goal, Kama Biliat, says the beauty of home and away competition is to make sure you get something on the road. Biliat says they need just one goal at home and make sure they don't concede. Sundowns will have to play the second leg of the MTN 8 semi-final against Chipa United at the Lucas Moripe Stadium just 3 days before the all-important clash. Sfiso Ramara, SABC News, Ndola in Zambia.
I believe there have been calls made to make Kama Biliat a naturalized South African citizen. With that goal-scoring ability, he will do very well going forward. Now, Watford dealt Manchester United a third successive defeat in 8 days with a deserved 3-1 Premier League win on Sunday that left Jose Mourinho raging at a rare run of failure. Goals from Etienne Capoue, Juan Zuniga and a stoppage-time penalty from Troy Deeney overwhelmed the visitors, who levelled with a solitary strike from Marcus Rashford in the day's big match. It was the first time that Watford had beaten United since 1986. It was also the first time that Mourinho had lost 3 consecutive games as a manager since 2006. He did say his expensively assembled team had to improve, but also suggested the referee had a little to do with the result.
I can split this in 3 factors. One is the referee's crucial mistakes. It's not in my control. I have nothing to do. I can't do nothing. I can't change that. You know, it's not under my control. Sometimes there are moments that go in your favor, go against you. And today is in our best moment that Gomez made that fantastic save. We were almost winning the game and we lose. I was completely aware that we were not a perfect team, that we had lots of players that are not ended products and can make their own mistakes. My only doubt was the way they can cope with the negative moment, because a negative moment will be always arriving sooner or later, will be always arriving. But I feel that some individuals, probably they feel too much that pressure and that responsibility. But I think by the collective point of view, I only have good things to say about them.
Surely it's his job to make sure that those individuals don't feel too much pressure and that the BMT gets built up in them. But anyway, I'm not a coach, just a sports anchor. Nico Rosberg leapfrogged his Mercedes teammate Lewis Hamilton in the Drivers' Championship in the 2016 Formula One Championship. The German came out tops in yesterday's Singapore Grand Prix, making it 3 wins in a row. It was Rosberg's 200th career start and is now 8 points ahead of Hamilton. An incredibly tough fight back from Daniel Ricciardo wasn't enough to pip the German from pole position.
Rosberg then on his 7th pole of the year, 4th front row start of the year for Daniel Ricciardo.
After pulling out a stunning lap to snatch pole position for the Singapore Grand Prix on Saturday, Nico Rosberg put himself in the best possible position for a 3rd consecutive race victory. It was a disastrous start to the race for Nico Hülkenberg, who was involved in the first lap carnage that led him to retire after colliding with a Toro Rosso car.
Contact. That's the Force India.
In the wall, there's Nico Hülkenberg in the wall. Ricciardo's held second. There's a battle for 4th place going on. And Raikkonen battling with Alonso. Where did he come from?
Other victims were Valtteri Bottas, who sustained a puncture, while Jenson Button lost a section of his front wing. In the process, Max Verstappen dropped to 8th, while Red Bull's Daniel Ricciardo remained 2nd. As Kimi Raikkonen was fast approaching the world champion for 3rd place, there wasn't much that Lewis Hamilton could do to shake off the Ferrari on his tail.
In comes Lewis Hamilton. So presumably this is to go onto a set of sticky tyres.
The Briton was being worried by his overheating brakes. He made a pit stop for super soft sticky tyres that took him to the end of the race. But his Mercedes teammate Rosberg held on to his lead ahead of Ricciardo to reclaim the championship lead.
But it's Nico Rosberg who wins in Singapore, his first ever win on the streets of Singapore in his 200th Grand Prix. What a result!
Hamilton fend off Raikkonen for 3rd as the Ferrari put pressure on the Mercedes into the final laps in a tough race marred by overheating brakes. Mduduzi Ndlovu, SABC News.
With 6 races to go, I tell you what, it's going to be a grand finale towards the end of this season. And I'll be chatting to our usual suspects, Xolele, as well as Jody, later on about 11:35, about that, as well as the Springboks and where to now, because since they're struggling still, having been walloped by the All Blacks over the weekend. That's where we're going to leave it for now. We'll be back at the top of the hour with more news and more analysis. You're watching Newsroom.
This is Trends, of course, your one-stop serving of all that's juicy and trending in the world of entertainment and showbiz. My name, of course, is Refiel Wemulo.
I'm Dr. Salomo Daung, and this is Our Talk.
A very good morning and welcome to Media Monitor. I'm your host, Alicia Jolly.
My name is Dumile Matez.
Kulemule Bazi.
My name is Mpo.
What time is it? It's question time.
For your daily dose of current affairs, tune in to the SABC News Champ.
love. This is my love. And I want to represent.
Yes, that was the great Mandoz. He's no longer, but we'll come to that in a short while. Let me just greet you. It's 1100 hours Central Africa time on this Monday, the 19th of September. This is Newsroom. If you've just joined us, Jumbo Africa, and a very warm welcome. I'm Elvis Presley.
And of course, I'm Renee Vest. Stay with us as we broadcast live from our Auckland Park studios here in Johannesburg. Now, our focus today is on the drug dealers who are using students to transport and sell drugs in various universities across the country.
It's a worrying trend, and we're asking you the question, is there perhaps a link between drugs and violence on our university campuses? Well, you can let us know what's on your mind. We also want to add alcohol in there, and how does that affect the entire situation? Let us know on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom, as well as on our Facebook page. But first, let's take a look at your news headlines. University students will know in just a moment whether they will be paying more for tuition fees next year. The Higher Education Minister will announce the anticipated 2017 university fee structure. We will cross there live as soon as it begins, so you have to stay tuned.
President Jacob Zuma has joined millions of South Africans in extending deep felt condolences on the passing of Kwaito legend Mduduzi Tshabalala, popularly known as Mandoza.
And the United Nations General Assembly gets underway today in New York, with South Africa aiming to play a meaningful role in the world body. Now, those are all your headlines, but before we get to the news with Renee, let's find out from Kendall Makamate what's happening on the sports front. Kendall.
Elvis, President Renee Vest, really good to be here with you. It's Monday morning. The unfortunate thing is we do wake up to Monday morning hearing about how Mandoza passed away, and definitely we're all sending condolences to his family.
Definitely a sad day for us all, yes.
Yeah, it is. It is. And if you don't know who Mandoza is, you need to know. He's a fantastic artist who brought Kwaito into the mainstream. This is what we've got for you in the sports today. As the 2016 Paralympics come to a close, Dion Bass and Hilton Langenhoffen earned gold and silver, respectively, bringing Team South Africa's total to 17 medals.
Great victory here by Assefa.
And in Cape Town, Assefa Ngegeo of Ethiopia makes history by running the fastest ever marathon on South African soil.
2 hours, 8 minutes, it looks like about 37 seconds, and that is the fastest unaided run on South African soil.
Nico Rosberg has just about got enough, I think. They're into the last corner. Ricardo's tried everything, but it's Nico Rosberg who wins in Singapore. His first ever win on the streets of Singapore in his 200th Grand Prix. What a result!
And Germany's Nico Rosberg celebrates his 200th Formula One race by retaking the championship lead from teammate Lewis Hamilton after a pole-to-flag win in Singapore. Of course, I'll be chatting to Jody and Scholle a little later on about the Springboks, the Formula One, as well as the Team SA's exploits out at the Paralympics a little later at 11:35. And now it's back to Renee, who's got the news.
Thank you very much, Kendall. The country is in mourning for Kwaito legend Mandoza, who died of cancer yesterday at the age of 38. Mandoza, whose real name is Mduduzi Tshabalala, lost his battle against the disease while being taken to hospital. President Jacob Zuma is among the many who have expressed their condolences. Despite being ill, Mandoza recently performed at the SABC's Thank You Concert at Orlando Stadium in Soweto.
I'm feeling more fire now.
The passing of a legend. The maestro was diagnosed with brain tumor. A frail-looking Mandoza appeared at an SABC concert just last week. At the time, Mandoza spoke about his illness.
I'm here to tell you, I'm still alive. I'm still going to rock you. Le cancer yahlanya.
He said, I'm going to perform and prove to the people that they said I'm dead. I'm not dead. I'll die on stage. I'll die singing. And I was born to do this.
Arrangements have not been finalized at this stage. The family is in mourning.
It's all right.
And you would always tell me, ever since in primary, I would always tell my daddy, daddy, I would like to go to a boarding school. And first thing he would say is, no. I never got a chance to spend time with my dad. So I'm willing to take that chance with you and the other two. So when I'm gone one day, that's what he said to me. Mm. I need you to be strong.
I'm severely touched by my brother's departure. I don't think it was his time, and it was hard for me even to come here when his manager asked me. I've been with this man for a long time. He's like my brother to me.
Mendoza was born in Zola South in Soweto. He was raised by his mother and his grandparents. The album Inkalakatsa in 2000 won multiple awards, soaring to the top of the charts on local radio. Hasina Gori, SABC News, Johannesburg.
Well, to his family and close relatives, the president has sent a message of condolences on behalf of the nation. And I can just add my humble voice that our hearts are broken. And at this very difficult time, our hearts go out to them, and may soul rest in eternal peace. He shall not be forgotten, because his music will play on.
Students will find out today whether they'll be paying more towards their tuition fees next year. Higher Education Minister Dr. Bladen Zimande is expected to announce the 2017 university fee structure in Pretoria shortly. Some student organizations have threatened protests if fees are hiked, saying this year's 0% increase must be carried over to next year. Universities say they need an increase of at least 8% to keep their operations running at full steam. The Council on Higher Education has recommended a 6% increase. Well, let's go live to that event right now as it starts.
They empower the next generation with skills and knowledge and contribute significantly to the ability of our economy to compete globally through innovative and appropriate research. Our universities currently face serious challenges in terms of funding. At the same time, large numbers of South Africans are currently finding it difficult to access post-school education because of the financial challenges they as individuals or as families face. Government is aware of these challenges and takes them very seriously. Indeed, government remains firmly committed to progressively realize free post-school education for the poor and working class, as called for by our constitution, and to assist middle-class families who are unable to pay. This is demonstrated by, amongst other things, the creation of the Presidential Commission of Inquiry into higher education and training funding, which includes universities and technical and vocational education and training colleges, which we call TVET colleges, as well as the substantial increases in funding to the National Student Financial Aid Scheme, NSFAS, since 2010. The task of the Presidential Commission is to advise on systemic and long-term measures to achieve a far-reaching reconstitution of the entire post-school education and training funding system, with a particular focus, of course, on student funding, thereby enabling South Africans to access higher education, even if they come from poor and working class families. The Presidential Commission recommendations will hopefully also contribute significantly to building and strengthening our universities and TVET colleges. And the Commission should be allowed to complete its vitally important task. In the interim, while we all wait for the recommendations of this Commission, our university system has to continue functioning, as well as our TVET college system, producing skills for the economy and empowering young South Africans and students from countries around the world, in particular the SADC community. Currently, our universities face an extremely difficult financial situation. The effects of last year's moratorium on fee adjustments and the extra costs associated with insourcing have both added to these challenges. Our immediate and pressing task is to ensure that as we continue to improve access to post-school education and strengthen the quality of learning and teaching, we do not erode the financial sustainability of the sector. Our economy is currently weak and our fiscal position parlous. The tax burden has been rising in recent years, and we must preserve the fiscal space to fund government's policy agenda in future years. And the Minister of Finance concurs on this. This means that any funding government mobilizes to support the pressing challenges in higher education, it would need to reprioritize from other government programs. We understand the legitimate student concerns about the affordability of university education. At the same time, we need to ensure that those who can afford to pay must pay. Equally important, the post-school budget has to cover students in technical and vocational education and training institutions, while we also face the challenge of building a community college sector to provide educational alternatives for 18 million South Africans who are unable to study at university. In other words, our job as government requires a number of very delicate balancing acts. To achieve our objectives, we must continue arguing for as significant a budget allocation as possible for post-school education. Indeed, a look at this year's budget shows that this sector received the largest increase in funding of any government department. Higher education and training this year received an additional 18% for 2016-2017, with an average annual increase of 9.8% across the medium-term expenditure framework period up till 2018 into 2019. From 42 billion rand in the 2015-16 financial year, the department's budget is set to rise to 55.3 billion in 2018-2019. Government has this year provided 1.9 billion of the 2.3 billion shortfall resulting from the subsidization of the 2016 university fee increase. More than 4.5 billion rands in the 2016-2017 financial year has been reprioritized to the National Student Financial Aid Scheme. If you add the other 10 billion in the hands of NSFAS, we are talking this year of 14.5 billion rands for NSFAS by government. Expanded funding is targeted to support 205,000 students entering universities for the first time or continuing this year, and a further 200,000 students at TVET colleges. This means that a total of 405,000 students would receive government support to access universities and colleges in 2016. The National Skills Fund has allocated, this is now in addition to NSFAS, has allocated 1.393 billion rand in 2016 towards funding undergraduate and postgraduate bursaries in scarce and critical skills. This funding is directed at meeting the full cost of study for over 13,500 undergraduate and 1,200 postgraduate students enrolled in programs at our 26 public universities. It's a significant amount of money that sometimes the media doesn't write about, because this is in addition to NSFAS, that we have got bursaries for students who are in critical and scarce skills to the tune of just under 1.4 billion. In addition, and perhaps most importantly, we must also ensure that we strengthen and empower those sectors which are charged with training and skilling people, either who choose not to go to university or who do not have the opportunity, but nevertheless must be assisted to become useful contributors to the economy. To support this aim, the National Skills Fund, again, has allocated 626 million in 2016 towards supporting TVET college students in occupational programs with a specific emphasis on occupations in high demand, and 1.237 billion rands towards funding students in workplace-based learning. This is above the amount of money we give to NSFAS for TVET college students. Artisan development is also key on our agenda to address the National Development Plan target of producing 30,000 artisans per annum by 2030. Dependent on the artisan trade, it costs between 350,000 to 400,000 over a period of 3 years to train an artisan. This year, the target is to register 30,750 new artisan learners, which will amount to approximately 4.6 billion rand in artisan learner grant funding through the Sector Education and Training Authorities, the SETAs. It is indeed a fine balancing act, and we must all participate, whether at the national level, in university administrations or college administration, or as student leaders, because it is the nature of balancing acts that if one falls, all fall. Last month, I received recommendations from the Council on Higher Education on university fees for 2017. I have studied these recommendations, consulted with university vice chancellors and council chairs, various student organizations, organized labor, faith communities, political organizations, and government. I wish to take this opportunity to thank the CHE for the work they've done in this regard. Ladies and gentlemen, the issues at stake are complex, and there are differing opinions and arguments across the system. The CHA argued for a consumer price index-based fee adjustment for 2017, while many university leaders have made a strong case that an 8% agreement or adjustment, which is CPI plus 2%, is essential to cover what is normally known as the higher education price index, which is usually CPI plus 2. On the other hand, some students have called for a moratorium on all fee adjustments until the outcome of the Presidential Commission is announced, whilst others are supporting government's measures to assist students from poor working and middle-class families, which includes what is sometimes called the missing middle. Currently, the authority for determining fee adjustments resides with university councils. The CHE has suggested to their leadership that the system will be best served by a national approach to this issue. However, at the same time, we do recognize the differentiated nature of the system, and that a one-size-fits-all approach may not lead to sustainability in the system over the long run. Must just underline here that the authority to set fees rests with university councils, not with the minister. Government is alive to the legitimate cries of students regarding fees and to those of the universities who must continue to pay for specialist books and equipment in foreign currency and ensure that academic support and service staff are adequately remunerated for their work. As we wrestle with how to respond comprehensively, the equally critical building and transforming of our post-apartheid universities and colleges has to be supported. Starving our universities and colleges of funding is not the way to go, which is effectively what another across-the-board fee rise moratorium against the current fiscal backdrop would mean at this point. While the Presidential Commission does its important work in developing proposals for a long-term funding model, universities and colleges will not be able to operate with less funds than what they already have. Everything is more expensive today than it was this time last year. Rates have gone up, whether it's electricity or for water and many other cost of living related items. That is the reality of inflation. We have looked at the challenges at hand from all sides and have concluded that the best approach would be to allow universities individually to determine the level of increase that their institutions will require to ensure that they continue to operate effectively and at least maintain existing quality, with the caution that this has to also take into account affordability to students and therefore has to be transparent, reasonable, and related to inflation-linked adjustments. Our recommendation is that the fee adjustment should not go above 8%. To ensure that such inflation-linked fee adjustments on the 2015 fee baseline are affordable to financially needy students, government is committing to finding the resources to support children of all poor, working and middle-class families, those with a household income of up to 600,000 rand per annum, with subsidy funding to cover the gap between the 2015 fee and the adjusted 27 fee at their institution. This will be done for fee increments up to 8%. This will in effect mean that all NSFAS qualifying students, as well as the so-called missing middle, that is, students whose families earn above the NSFAS threshold but who are unable to support their children to access higher education, will experience a no-fee increase in 2017, all those categories of students. Government will pay for the fee adjustment, which means the taxpayer will pay for the fee adjustment. This will bring huge relief to nurses, teachers, police, social workers, and other parents who work in occupations that do not earn huge salaries and who have children at university. This will apply to students at universities and TVET colleges this time around. Administrative mechanisms will be developed and students informed on how to apply for the gap funding grant before the end of this academic year. There are many students from upper middle class and well-off families, as well as students on full company bursaries in our institutions who can afford to pay the adjusted 2017 fees, and we expect them to do so. It is very unclear, for instance, to government why families who can afford private schools in this country should, under the current circumstances, be receiving further state subsidies for their children at universities. To subsidize these students would require taking funding from the poor to support cheaper higher education for the wealthy, which is not justifiable in a context of inequality in our country. We cannot subsidize the child of a cleaner or unemployed person in the same way as we subsidize the child of a highly paid advocate or investment banker, for instance. While NSFAS will continue to provide loans and bursaries to poor students, the Department of Higher Education and Training and universities will continue to mobilize institutional and private sector financial support to enable affordable financial aid options for the missing middle students. We're fairly advanced, in fact, with investigating a system that will also assist students from the missing middle to actually access funding for university and college education. I have constituted then to this effect the ministerial task team on funding support for the poor and missing middle students, which is developing a model that will be tested in 2017 to provide affordable support to these students. We will continue to look for other ways of supporting financially needy students not covered by NSFAS, whilst a long-term solution is being developed to raise sufficient funding from the public sector, the private sector, and other sources to fund missing middle students at universities and TVET colleges. Universities must urgently, effectively, and comprehensively advance our shared transformation as articulated in the 2015 Durban Statement on transformation and provide annual reports on their progress, as we strongly believe that whilst it is legitimate to focus on issues of student fees, other aspects of transformation of universities must not lag behind. Moreover, universities are also expected to pay all of their staff, both permanent and contracted, a fair living wage. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That is the statement. As I said, the panel will take questions. We'll take them in a set of three questions. So I'm going to open for questions in Pretoria. And I have three hands, or the statement is clear enough. I'll show me one hand. Minister, it seems like we're moving much faster. One, two, saw another hand this
side?
Three. Yep. Please introduce yourself and tell us which
media. Alright, Sipo Stillman from SABC TV News. Just for sake of clarity, Minister, you mentioned that NSFAS qualifying students and the so-called missing middle will not experience any fee increment. Can you just tell us what have you budgeted to cover this gap going forward? And also, if you can also, just also a sake of clarity, so does this mean now the missing middle still fund their own studies and the government will only come in to fund the gap that would have been caused by the fee increment? If you can just offer that, clarify that for me. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Oh, same question. There was another question.
Honorable Minister, my name is Mawar Suleiman from Chinese TV News Nigeria. From the breakdown now, no mention have been done on foreign students who are here. They are paying far more than the locals. Is this going to affect them, or what is their stand now? Thank you.
Okay, Gerardo. You can take the opportunity to the other hand as well.
Sure, it's Laurenti Tan from ENCA. Just to add to my colleague's question about the missing middle, I mean, how many people are we talking about? How many students do we envisage will be qualifying for this this provision? And also, just to give us more clarity on the figures, how much has been budgeted for this missing middle?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Minister. Over to you.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Sorry. Oh, okay. Sipo, you are correct that we are going to be covering both NSFAS students and the missing middle. NSFAS students, obviously, they are paid for. Tuition fees, accommodation, food, and books. The missing middle, you are correct. What we are going to be subsidizing is the increase for this year. But as the statement goes on to say, as from next year, we are actually piloting a system appropriate to the missing middle, not just to give them relief on fees, but also on how nurses, teachers, and so on can be able to also to access loans for their students so that they are able not to pay any fee upfront, with the aim of implementing that by 2018, hopefully. But we are of the view, we are strongly of the view that this is for the first time, in fact, that we are acting as government on the missing middle in this way. We think that a no-fee, experience of a no-fee increase for the missing middle is going to make a huge difference, because it means they are not going to be paying extra money. All those of families whose household income is up to 600,000 rand. Whilst the other processes are continuing of finding a lasting solution to the missing middle, as well as the work being done by the Presidential Commission. As to where and how the money will come from, unfortunately, I'm not the Minister of Finance. I cannot be able to address that. I'm hoping the Minister of Finance will possibly signal something in the medium-term budget policy statement. But also, I can't commit him in his absence as to when and how he will do this. It will be him who will actually be addressing that question. Foreign students, you must remember that we have a SADC agreement that all students from SADC region will be charged fees as if they were local students. But from the rest of the continent and the rest of the world, they will be charged fees that are charged other foreign students, with the exception of two countries in the continent. It's South Sudan, which we treat as a SADC country, as well as, is it Rwanda? Is it Rwanda? Yes. Because of the conditions, you know, and the past in those countries. So which means that SADC students will benefit from this if they are to be charged as local students. How many students are going to benefit? We estimate, you see, remember also we are still going to be doing the exercise by the universities and colleges to determine. But in terms of our own statistical estimation, is that this intervention is going to benefit 70% of all undergraduate students in our university system, which is enormous. It's quite an important intervention that will have palpable effect in the pockets of all those who are going to be experiencing a no-fee increase. Am I leaving out something on that?
Yeah, how much?
How much?
How much will it cost?
No. As to how much you want to come in, DJ?
Yeah, it's fine. No, in respect to the cost, there are engagements with the Treasury at the present moment into determining exactly how much will this be dipping into the public purse. And it's covering both universities as well as TVET college sectors. And the rough work thus far that we have undertaken is showing some indications, though not conclusive, around 2.56 billion or so. But it's not conclusive at the present moment. And the rough work across the system in collaboration, we have done in collaboration with Stats SA as well as Treasury through engagement with our institutions as well. We may be talking about plus or minus 70 to 80% of the student population, you know, currently that government would have to bear costs for. Those are the indications that are coming up, Minister, to this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can we go to Cape Town? Cape Town, can we take three questions, please?
Yes, we have questions in Cape Town. Paul?
Minister, with a benefit of hindsight,
introduce yourself, please, right now.
Wendell from Reuters. Minister, do you think that the last year's no fees moratorium has created a legitimate expectation on the students that they won't be any fee increases going forward? And certainly, we're seeing that being played out currently at universities, some of which are closed. Was that decision for a no fees moratorium a political decision in the run up to the elections, or was it properly thought through? And just lastly, on the question of the recommended cap of 8%, what happens if in the for example, you have your former historically black universities saying that, you know, they need the fees more than your other white universities, if I can put it as bluntly as that. Now, so what is to prevent them from not honoring the cap? I mean, is there a mechanism that if they say we need to go higher because our circumstances are different, how do you then enforce the recommendation if it is such? Thanks.
That will be all for now, because Paul earlier on passed the ball to Wendell. So we'll send back to you, Harold.
Okay, we'll take other two questions from Victoria.
Good morning, Minister Anton Meyer from Pretoria FM. We've heard from various student organizations and student leaders that they will not accept any fee increase and that they are demanding another 0% fee increase. There will certainly be sectors of the society that will not be happy with your announcement today of the 8% cap. Universities will enforce then a fee increase up to 8%. What's your message to these students that said they will go out and shut down universities again? Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Chriselda Lewis from SABC and Television News. Mine adds to the question asked by my colleague. We understand that at Wits University, at the moment where students had gathered to listen to your address, Minister, they're saying they're not happy with the decision that you have made, and they are now threatening to shut down Wits University, saying that they've been calling all along for a 0% increase. What's your message to those students?
Okay, you want to take the last one?
Hello. Okay. My name is Jalen Nomo from ENN7. Also adding to that, Minister, your recommendation of 8% not go about, you said your fee adjustment should not go above 8%. The tertiary institutions have warned that anything below 8% increase would cripple them financially. So what would be that impact? Have you consulted with them? What is their view on this?
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Start with Wendell. I think that, firstly, I wouldn't say that firstly, let's make one thing clear. Fees did go up this year by 6%. We mustn't forget that. Fees did go up by 6% this year. So to say that there was no fee increase, it's not correct. It's just that those fee increases were largely paid for by government and some of the universities who could raise some money.
The fact of the matter is, we want as wide a range of students to experience a no-fee increase, but someone is paying, is the taxpayer. And as we say, things go up. They don't wait for commissions. They do go up. It's a fact. And also the issue that some universities are in a very precarious situation means that an adjustment has to be made. Now, how do we enforce this? Well, we've reached an agreement with the vice chancellors and the university council chairpersons that given the sensitivity of this matter, they would all commit to be guided centrally. So it's their own commitment. We haven't usurped any institution's powers. We hope that through that commitment, then, they will be hopefully be bound by this. Now, what is the message to the students? Government policy as it stands is that we are supporting students from poor backgrounds. There is no free higher education for everyone. One of the unintended consequences of a no-fee increase or of paying for everyone so that there would be no fee increase for them is that we paid for parents who can afford and the wealthy. I am sure that the students cannot position themselves to be fighting for wealthy parents, for example, or parents who may not be wealthy but who can afford to pay. Now, we must not, even if we are making interim interventions as we are doing now, whilst waiting for the commission, for instance, the presidential commission, to finish things, we can't begin to do and create expectations which are wrong. It is incorrect in a country like South Africa that we should actually pay for parents who can afford as well as for the rich. We lost millions of rands this year, for example, from corporates who are paying scholarships. Many were saying to us, why did you include us in this? Because we could have afforded, because that extra money we need, and that extra money is also precisely needed so that it could further support poor students in other ways other than just student fees. So we want to say to the students, whilst they have a right to protest, but they must actually also, they have a duty to understand we're a highly unequal country. We think this coverage is actually covering a larger number of parents. That is why also we are calling upon parents to also come and join us and actually assist us in saying, teachers, nurses who were going to be paying are now not going to be paying a fee increase in 2017, so that we are able also at the end of the day to approach our universities. I am aware that there are sections of people who want to use these legitimate concerns of students for their own narrow political agendas. We are saying to the students, please do not be misled. This is a very, very big intervention by government, a first of its kind. Students can't be mobilized to actually struggle for parents who can afford and to campaign for the rich, because that's what it will end up being. Let a moratorium, it means you are campaigning for the rich. That is the view of government, and that is the policy of government. And by the way, we have also consulted very widely on this. We just need to say that we were consulting very widely. There is huge consensus around this. That is why we are announcing it confidently. There is huge consensus amongst youth formations, amongst students' formations, amongst faith communities, and many other
institutions, the trade union movement, to say this is the correct way to go. There was something about a figure die which I thought maybe... ANN7, what are you saying about below 8%? Sorry?
Sorry, the tertiary institutions have said any recommendations are 8% and below would cripple the institutions.
Yes, we agree with them. Because we must be careful. We have the largest and most respected higher education system on the African continent. We have 70,000 foreign students in our universities. Proportionately, we are amongst the highest in the world in terms of the proportion of students, foreign students, who are studying in our institutions. These institutions must also be accessible, be kept so that they are accessible to the poor and generations to come. Because one of the things we do not want to do is to start to see a process where rich families begin to send their children to overseas institutions in Europe and North America. Because that income is very crucial for actually assisting us in a society that has got such high inequalities. That is why we engage the universities and took into account what they are saying. We can't destroy our universities in the name of defending no fee increases for the rich. There was something which was about a figure. What was it?
It was about this.
And I see now a few hands. I take it this is the last round. Should I take
this?
Gilton, are there any last hands there?
Yes, we do.
Let's take those last hands.
Okay.
Right, now you're watching Newsroom now. We're about to go to the University of the Witwatersrand, where we've got a briefing on the go. It's about the fees must fall as well as the government's response to it. Here, over to Ishmael right now.
A very good day indeed. We are here at Perth University's concourse under the roof of what is now known as Solomon Matlango House. We are here, the students, as you can see behind me, are singing, of course, expressing their displeasure about the long wait that we've seen from the Department of Higher Education and Training with regard to the announcement of the fees or the fee increment for 2017. But what we know is that this is the particular Fees Must Fall campaign that started last year, and it is now dragged today as we're speaking. But as the minister was announcing that particular fee increment announcement, the students were gathering here. They were attentively listening, and of course, some of course saying that they've waited long enough. But to join me just to tell us about their immediate reaction here is Fasiha Hassan. She is the VET SRC Secretary General. Fasiha, thanks so much for your time. You heard the announcement earlier on by the minister. Your immediate reaction, please.
We were gathered here, thousands of students, as you can see behind us. We were the first to hear it. I think there's a lot of anger on the ground. The first issue is the fact that Minister Nzimande has said it is still the prerogative of councils of institutions of higher learning that will decide on a fee increment. That speaks to institutional autonomy, but it's highly problematic because one of the points we raised in 2015 and last year was that institutions were arbitrarily and exorbitantly raising fee increments, and we needed intervention. That's the first thing. But the second thing is that Blade barely spoke about free education. The fact is, that is the focus of what Fees Must Fall is. A moratorium assists, but it doesn't really deal with the issue of access to education. And that is ultimately what we are fighting for, and ultimately what our primary goal is.
I mean, he talked about the feasibility of free education, which I know you guys are busy discussing about it at this point in time. What is your standpoint at this point in time? Because we know that there's a fees commission that's underway. What's your take on this?
It's highly problematic that the Fees Commission is investigating the mere feasibility. We reject these terms of reference. This Fees Commission should in fact be investigating modalities. How are we going to realize free and quality education, not whether it is possible or not? So that's the first thing. But the second thing is the delay. It was set to report back at the end of this year and thus provide a way forward for 2017. But it hasn't. It's now only going to provide a way forward in 2017, May. And that is really why we're having these issues. At the beginning of next year, thousands of people, again, are going to be excluded from institutions of higher learning because we haven't dealt with the issue as well.
Will we be correct to say that this is now the start of fees must fall 2016?
I think that would be correct to say. We're here and we will do whatever we have to do. We condemn violence. We don't condone it. And we want to be very, very clear that there will be no arson on the part of the WITS SRC. However, we will do whatever we have to do to ensure the realization of free and quality education.
Now, our exams are just around the corner. What are you actually planning to do ahead?
Today, we'll probably meet with students. Obviously, our mandate comes from students themselves. And we'll only be able to provide a way forward after we've met with the collective.
Fasiya, thanks so much for your time indeed. There you are indeed. What was the WITS SRC expressing their displeasure about the announcement by the minister, of course. So from here, as you can see behind me, the Fees Must Fall campaign is already underway. This is Fees Must Fall 2016 as we know it. And we were just a few weeks away from celebrating the first year anniversary. So this is what the students are saying. They need this zero fee increment to be carried over to 2017. And of course, we know that the free education is part of this demand they have here. So we will just wait and see how it goes from today onwards. Back to you in studio.
More of a validation, you know, it's more of like, okay, you're on it. Because it's been a dream and a goal from the beginning, like, to get here.
The fact that the rest of the world is actually acknowledging the amount of work we put into, you know, into music as Africa as a whole, I think it's fantastic. It's a big one for South Africa too.
The School of Ballet in Nigeria has changed many a mindset in dance.
Saw it a lot on TV and we looked at it like something that probably could not be taught to us because we thought it was like a white man dance or probably something they just, it's their culture now, but it actually taught me that it's not just about culture because dance is a language.
For more arts and entertainment news, catch Trends every Saturday from 12 to 1.
That universities have said how it can be done in a manner that it minimizes too much expense on students. I don't want, by the way, Samgelo, if I come back, to be debating with SAUS through the media. SAUS has been consulted, and SAUS has indicated that it would be satisfied with an announcement along these lines.
Thank you very much. Colleagues, this is the end of the media briefing. Those who still want the interviews and one-on-one, particularly on camera, we're open to that so that we can clear them. But the minister has got other pressures, so we need to quickly do those. Cape Town, are you saying that there's a last question there?
Yes, please. From Paul. Paul, please take this one. Minister Paul from Bloomberg again. There was talk in the February budget about transferring surpluses from the CETAs into helping to deal with this fee problem. Could you tell us what progress is coming through on that?
Okay, that will be the last question, and then we close.
That's what we did this year.
Sorry,
when the point of clarity.
What is the point of clarity? We need to close now.
Yes, so forgive me. Thanks, Alan. Forgive me. To the DG, what's the figure that he mentioned? I didn't hear quite so nicely. Was it 2.9 billion that he says that they were talking about the treasury, please? Thank you.
Okay, did you want to?
No, it's
the odd from Cape Town.
It's plus or minus 2.5 up to 2.6. I didn't feature 0.9 at all. Oh. Thank you very much.
Then 2.5 to 2.6. You heard that correctly, right? Thank you.
Well, this year we had to use surpluses from the sitters to offset part of the government money, as the Minister of Finance had explained, came from the sitter surpluses for 2016. It's not clear for 2017. As I said, the Minister of Finance will be the one who actually makes the appropriate announcements, possibly including where money has come from or is going to come from.
Thank you very much, that's the end. There is some refreshments for journalists on the other side, but those that need interviews, please come to the front here and give us them so we can release them. Thank you very much.
We'll wait for the aftermath.
Yes.
For the aftermath. And relax, no doubt.
Baba,
I'm
prepared.
Tell you about Africa's social media and technology landscape. 21st century.